And there's a look at downtown Los Angeles. L.A., of course, known for its palm trees, movie stars, sunshine, and yes, champions. That's the Toyota Sports Center, where we are as the Lakers begin their quest for that coveted three-peat. Yes, banners hang from the rafters like Christmas ornaments here all around. Jerseys and banners, plenty of talent in this building. This team loaded with talent. Some new and some old, plenty of old, actually. Mark Fine alongside Norm Nixon. And Norm, I don't know that we've ever had less attention paid to a back-to-back championship team than we've got this year. Few changes for the Lakers, but one thing that won't change is a very good basketball team.
Well, I think Miami took all the headlines this summer. But again, this team is in familiar territory, and for sure for Phil Jackson, who's going for his fourth three-peat. So Phil has a lot to look forward to, and I think if you need anything to get you motivated, I think winning a third championship is something that can have you motivated.
Now, you know a little bit something about championships. We want to make sure we introduce you to my co-host here. If you're not familiar, maybe you forgot a little bit about his career. It wasn't that long ago. But
it was actually a long time.
two championships for you here wearing the Laker gold, and actually led the team in scoring in 82. 10-year career, averaged more than 15 points and 8 assists per game for the Lakers. Pretty impressive numbers, my friend.
Well, it was a lot of fun. I had a good time here. I had opportunity to win championships here. Then I got traded across town to Siberia. Didn't win anymore, but we had a lot of fun here. And championships, what it's all about.
Well, you talk about those championships and the tradition here with the Los Angeles Lakers, because there are some franchises that just separate themselves, and this is one of those franchises.
Well, it starts at the top, and it starts with Dr. Buss. I mean, with anything else in any organization, you look at in football, you look at the Patriots, in baseball, you look at the Yankees, but it starts with the top, and I think Jerry Buss has been a great owner. He paid when he had to. And, you know, Los Angeles is not a bad place to attract people as well. So when you have a great franchise, a great city, great fans, I mean, it's easier to get the talent here.
Well, let's tell you a little bit about what we're going to have for you today. Obviously, we call it Real Training Camp. You're going to get to see some practice. We're going to watch these guys. You've got Phil Jackson and the team behind us getting ready to go for their practice. We've got players mic'd. Ron Artest is wearing the microphone for us today. That is going to be interesting. And Sasha Vujacic wearing a microphone
Quick
for
question.
Us today as well.
Is there a 10-second delay on those mics?
No, there's not. We are live, and it's going to be a lot of fun. Hey, it was a lot of fun for the Lakers last year on the road to that championship as we take a little bit of a look at their record over or their run to repeating. You look at what they did in the postseason, winning the first round against the Thunder, you know, all of these series, but that first round against the Thunder is the one that really jumps out at me. What an exciting series that was to get them on their way.
I tell you, it was youth against old veterans, and those young legs gave the Lakers fits, and I tell you, that is a very good team, and that's a team that I think the Lakers are really going to have to be concerned about this season.
Well, you look at that finals, 4-3 over the Celtics, a 7-game series that we will not soon forget. Let's take a look back now at the Lakers and the Celtics, 2009-2010 NBA Finals.
You know, at this point, you know, the important thing is to win every game.
This is the finals. There's no more rules, no mistakes.
Lakers and the Celtics. It just sounds right at this time of year. Artest knocks down the three. 12 seconds, first half. Rondo's going to have to put it up. Rondo fires away. Knocks it down. There's a three. The Lakers take game one.
Definitely got to be more intense game two. Took some step backs game one, but very bounce back game two. Right now.
Fires a three. Knocks it down. Gasol inside. Counted out of foul. Stolen by Bryant. Bad pass. Puts up the three. Bang! Back out to Allen for three. Puts it in. And that's an NBA Finals record. Most threes in a Finals game. His eighth. And that's going to do it. The Celtics are going to tie this series at one apiece. The TD Garden is packed. It's loud, and the Celtic fans are ready. Perkins blocked. Once again, the Lakers size stopping the Celtics. Garnett jumper knocks it down. Rondo to the basket, flips it up, banks it in. 1-point game. Fisher to the basket, gets hammered, and he puts it in. And the Lakers are going to regain home court advantage.
Good start is nice, and we proved that the other night. But a good finish is more important.
Back-to-back threes for Kobe Bryant. He's got that look right now.
Hey, listen up! Listen up! Hey, let's finish the game! Finish the game!
Davis, the ball for Bryant. Excellent! Tie game.
taking it to the basket on it. Just take a stop.
Davis the rebound. Banks him in. And a foul.
Len Davis has completely turned the tide here in game four. And now this NBA final has the makings of something really special.
Oh, Rondo with a little English off the glass.
Bryant from way downtown.
Bang!
They lob it into Gasol.
Oh, blocked by Tony Allen. He came from nowhere. All tipped up and in. Oh, what a play from Rajon Rondo.
Nobody expected them to be one win away from winning it all.
Rondo ahead to Garnett. Garnett, nice move inside. Just spots up. That's a three. Ron Artest. Shot it down. Wow.
But what can Brown do for you? Jump out the building and finish. Make you look good.
Don't stand and watch this game. No time for spectating.
You know, in 20 years from now, we're going to come back and we're going to have this reunion party. And when we shake hands, let's make sure our ring's touched.
It's a moment and a game that kids dream about. What a roller coaster ride these finals have been.
Here's the drive. Gets to the rim. Block from behind. Wallace puts up the three. It's good. Wallace from downtown. Artest, that's a three. Bang! The Lakers repeat back-to-back titles.
Kobe then and Kobe now. Kobe Bryant stretching out and getting ready for practice here today. And again, we're going to have practice for you as the Lakers get ready to go here on Real Training Camp. And Norm, a look at where he stands in terms of this franchise with his postseason marks as we just come off that little feature there about last year's finals.
Well, I tell you, Kobe is unbelievable. I mean, I had an opportunity to really watch him over the last 3 to 4 years, and I have a different respect for this guy. But the one thing he will always bring to the table, his work ethic. He works harder than anybody I've ever seen in the offseason, and I think that's a lesson for all young ball players. As great as he is, he outworks everybody. And someone made an interesting saying, hard work beats talent when talent fails to work hard. And he's one of those guys that I think you have a problem with.
Write that down. Hard work beats talent.
When talent fails to work hard. That's a great quote.
And another thing about Kobe is that he's played through injuries. That was one of the things that he did in last year's. But don't forget all those offensive numbers he puts up. He had to play through injuries. That's going to be one of the storylines as we go forward here this season as we look at him again getting ready to go here today. Let's take a look back, though, first, again, as we set this up at some of the numbers. First of all, offensively for the Lakers, and again, much of the season, Kobe dealing with that finger injury, and yet they were still so strong offense.
Well, you think about Pau Gasol missed the first part of the season. Kobe was hurt. Bynum was hurt. So this team dealt with a lot of injuries throughout the season. But if you know Phil Jackson, the regular season is not what it's about. You want to get through the regular season and be in a good position and try to have everybody healthy for the playoffs. So this team didn't play as well as it did the previous year during the regular season, but they did what they had to do. They got in a good position. They had home court throughout the Western Conference.
And some of these numbers, though, tell you really about the style of play, I think, as much as anything. When you look at 24th in three-point percentage and 25th in fast breaks, that's not necessarily a bad thing, I think. The thing I want to point out in terms of if that's not the type of basketball.
Well, one of my things is game is won inside out. Right. Anytime. Okay. It's one from inside out. You live by that jump shot, you die by that jump shot. I think that's one. When you think about Orlando Magic team, I think one of the biggest problems with that team, they lead the league in three-point field goals attempts. They're a great three-point shooting team, but they don't win the big games because when you rely on that type of shot, invariably you're going to die because of that type of shot.
And another saying is that championships are won with defense, right? And that's
absolutely
where the numbers have to be more impressive. If we take a look at the numbers for the Lakers defensively, you see, yes, these are a little more impressive than the offensive numbers.
Well, the defensive number, they will always go out there defensively. I think when you have the type of size, when you have 2 7-footers inside, it make it very difficult for a lot of teams to get to the basket. And again, the game is won from inside out. And with the size that the Lakers have on the court, most of the time, they do a pretty good job.
And what did they do this offseason? They go out and add Matt Barnes, a very aggressive defender, and Theo Ratliff, a guy that can block shots. So
exactly.
It shows you that they are aware what they are going to need. You take a look at Pau Gasol there, well-rested. We're going to talk about all these guys. There is Barnes getting ready for today's practice as we go through the course of this practice today. The other thing we got to talk about is this year ahead for the Los Angeles Lakers. A number of key games for them. We wanted to show you a few of those, but you talked about it. Really, it's a pacing through the regular season, right?
It's a pacing through the regular season. You want to have your your legs are burning. You want guys to play enough minutes, but you don't want to wear your team out during the regular season. And again, Phil has been one of the best coaches, and it's obvious because of his record, and pacing his team to having them ready for the playoffs.
You know, as we look at these games, and of course, we picked the ones that we thought were important. It just so happens they're all on national television, so I guess our folks behind the scenes knew what they were doing, and obviously the TV networks want to have the best games on. The first game jumped out at me, though, against the Suns on October 29th, because one of the big stories right now, Norm, is Andrew Bynum and his knee. Some questions as to whether or not he should have gotten knee surgery right when the season was done. He chose not to. There is a whole story there, but now the question is, when will he be ready? A little discrepancy between what Phil Jackson said yesterday. He's thinking maybe in October he'll be ready. Bynum said maybe not until the end of November, but that's going to be an important thing for this team when he does come back.
Well, let's talk about it. You're talking about a difference in 10 days. I think 10 days does not make a big difference in your season. When he comes back, if it's up to me, I hold him out until he gets healthy. The worst thing you can do is rush Andrew back and have him get injured. So if it takes him a little longer, I'm off with saying, take your time, big guy. Get back, get healthy, because it's more important for him to play the second half of the season heading into the playoffs, as we talked about earlier. So I think it would be very smart of Bynum and very smart of the Lakers to just allow him to get 100%, because you don't need him initially during the regular season.
And we're going to get a chance to talk with Mitch Kupchak about that, about his injury and the timing of his return. I think, again, there's a whole story there. We'll have time to share it and give kind of both sides to that story and see how it will affect the Lakers as they start this season. As you look at Phil Jackson, we're going to take a timeout, let him get ready to get the troops going. We will have, again, Ron Artest will have the microphone on for us today, as will Sasha Vujacic. We'll have interviews. We'll talk to the team, the people around the team. A lot of fun. Real Training Camp, LA Lakers style, continues after a quick timeout.
Take it through all my numbers. 15, my dad wore 51 in high school, so I changed it around. 15 in high school, 15 at St. John's, 15 in Chicago, my first year at Indiana, 15. Then I went to 23 for Michael Jordan. Then I went to 91 for Dennis Rodman, traded to Sacramento. Then I went for 93 for the 9 being a Q and the 3 being an uppercase V. Went to Houston, the 96, the 9 is a Q and the 6 is a lowercase V. And now I'm in LA, and 37 represents the number of weeks that Thriller was number one, Michael Jackson's album, greatest selling album of all time. I spoke to some of his family members, and they was real happy, you know, that I picked the number.
And now he's going back to his high school number again. He's going to wear that this year. And boy, he knew every story behind every number, didn't he?
Well, you know, you got a little Dennis Rodman in him. You know, Dennis learned from Madonna, and so Ron has learned from Dennis.
And from Michael Jackson also, don't forget. Hey, you know, he is a lot of fun. He certainly has added a different personality to this team, no question about that. But, hey, just like Rodman, he brings it on the basketball court as well, and was a very important part of what this team did last year.
Well, especially in the playoffs. I mean, the question was, do you keep Trevor Reeves bring him on Artest?
Yeah,
Trevor was a great defensive player. Quickness you can't replace. Artest came in with a different type of attitude, and he earned his money in the playoffs. Then offensively, he struggled throughout the year to try to find his place with this team offensively. They didn't need him to score. Other places, he had been the man. So he came here, and now you're the third or fourth option offensively. I'm sure that was very difficult for him. But he came through big in the playoffs in some of the games scoring, and defensively he definitely had his hands full with the guys he had to look at.
And you know, I think it is interesting when you talk about that kind of character, personality that he has. You never know how those guys are going to handle those situations, and as much as his play, his good, strong play was a key, that key in him understanding his role and buying into that role was huge for the Lakers.
Well, this is one thing everybody must understand. Championship teams police themselves. Dennis Rodman was not a problem with Phil in Chicago. He had Phil Jackson, he had Michael Jordan, he had Pippen. Ron Artest was not going to be a problem here. You had established veterans. You had Kobe, you had Pau Gasol, you had Lamar Odom, who was a childhood friend. So championship teams police that. And it's amazing how God can be such a maverick in other places and come into a championship situation and blend totally with the team. And Ron is example of that.
Yeah, and another great What's thing that? About what he has done in coming here, this is a guy who's decided he is going to auction off his championship ring. He needs to win another one because he's going to auction this one off for charity, and, of course, a lot to be said for that. You talk about the leadership. You know, it's all got to start at the top. And Dr. Jerry Buss, I know that you're very familiar with him and got an opportunity to work for him. He was finally inducted into the Hall of Fame. We're going to take a look at that right now.
In 1979, Jerry Buss ushered in an era of success unrivaled in the history of Southern California professional sports. That's when he acquired the Los Angeles Lakers.
There he is, his first shot as an owner. You think he likes it?
As a rookie owner in 1979, his first act as owning the Lakers was drafting a kid by the name of Urban Magic Johnson. That first year, the two rookies together won an NBA championship.
And I want to present the World Trophy to the owner of the Los Angeles Lakers, rookie Jerry Buss.
With the leadership of Jerry Buss and the skills of Magic, the Lakers were winning with a flashy new style.
It is showtime. Oh, what a play!
Showtime was the NBA in the 80s. I mean, that's what everybody paid attention to.
Showtime!
Me as a fan growing up, that's what drew me to the game was Showtime. And he's the mastermind behind all of it.
Hey, look at this! What?
His Lakers took the NBA by storm with 5 championships in the 1980s. But they were more than just a great team, as Jerry would make them one of the hottest shows in Tinseltown.
He said, I want to turn this basketball game into entertainment. So he started the Laker Girls. Then he said, you know what? I want celebrities in the building. Going to a Laker game is an event.
In 1999, Buss moved the Lakers into a new home, the Staples Center. And that season, he would also launch a new dynasty with the first of 3 straight NBA titles, followed by 2 more later in the decade.
It was the rebuilding of the team that changed the Lakers again and made them back in power.
Bryant to Shaq!
It's been a team that people from the community in LA want to see. I mean, it's all due to what Dr. Buss had as a vision.
Dr. Buss, congratulations to the NBA champion, Los Angeles Lakers.
Jerry's lasting legacy is a record of unmatched excellence on the court and in generally shepherding the growth of our league on his watch.
He was a fun-loving man who took this enormous pride in owning this team. It was good to see him win.
Without this man, we would not have won all the championships that we have won.
It's great that Dr. Buss is in the Hall of Fame because he managed to do it the right way. And there's no blueprint for that. You know, it's just your instincts. And, you know, his instincts were sound. And the success of the franchise is proof of that.
Everybody in Los Angeles was so excited and happy for him, especially when we see all the players that we have in the Hall of Fame, and now our great owner gets to follow that.
Boy, in the 25 years prior to him taking over the team, they had won 1 title, 10 titles now. That is a record for the league for Jerry Buss. You got a quick story? Any quick fun story? I'm sure there are a lot of stories. How about ones that we can tell on television about Jerry Buss?
I won't tell a story. I just say this. I mean, Jerry was a guy that really understood how to mix entertainment with sports. I think Magic alluded to that. And he was a bachelor. So you had a playboy owner with this exciting basketball team. And we happened to win the championship the first year he owned the team. So what a combination to put this team out on the map. And I think, like you say, Jerry was the orchestrator of that whole thing.
Yeah, it's one thing to have the showtime and to have all the glitz and the glitter, but he did obviously back it up with a vision, as they talked about there in that piece. Hey, we're going to head to a quick timeout. When we come back, practice, they are starting to get ready to get underway here. Again, we've got players mic'd up, coaches. We're going to break it down for you. Real training camp, Lakers style, continues after a quick timeout.
Killed right across the lane.
Oh, man.
Pau Gasol
finds a trailing Gasol on a lob pass, and the Spaniard thumps it down.
Gasol stays on.
Vamos!
Gasol. The rebound and the two. Pau Gasol.
And there's a look at Pau Gasol as real training camp, Lakers style, continues here at the Toyota Sports Center. Mark Fine alongside Norm Nixon. Norm, you know, again, so many reasons why this team has had success. Pau Gasol, a big part of the reason for their success. And coming into this season, a little bit different for him because he's a little more rested.
He came in and he's injury free because I was just trying to put like a timetable in my head. In 08, they had lost to Boston. You had the Olympics. Then they came back, won the championships. You had the world championships. They came back, won the championship again. I think he needed to rest. Last season, he came in, he injured himself because I think he didn't take the opportunity to rest his body. He spoke earlier about being a little upset because he watched Spain lose in the world championship,
right.
But his primary gig is the NBA. So it's fortunate that he did take that rest now, and he should come into camp refreshed and healthy.
And maybe you can explain to some of the fans the thought process for these guys, because some people think playing for your country is such an honor, but it's not like he hasn't done it. This is a guy who's played in the Olympics. He's played in the FIBA tournament before, and at some point you've got to go do your job.
Well, you got to do your job, but you put your body at risk. I mean, Kobe, another guy, he took the summer off. A lot of these guys, you'll see, 82-game season. That's a long season. Now you put 9 exhibition games on it, up to 20 playoff games on it. Wear and tear on your body is tremendous. I tell guys, after you play 7-8 years, whether you've had a major injury or not, your body hurts. You'll be under those ice packs and ice bags after every practice and after every game. Powell is later in his career, and you can believe he's sore just from the normal wear and tear. So at some point in time, yes, you want to go play for your country, but you have to take in consideration not only your job, but your personal health.
Now, this is a guy whose character can't be questioned as well. Very interesting individual. At one point wanted to be a doctor, still may want to pursue that at some point after his career. He's an ambassador for UNICEF, and actually Phil Jackson was joking yesterday during media day. He thinks he's an ambassador to the world. He didn't just sit at home watching TV over the offseason. This is a guy who's out doing a lot of good.
He was out doing a lot of good, but he wasn't running up and down the court and
right.
Putting that stress on his body. But, yeah, I know he's a very ambitious guy, and he talks about being a doctor. But to go back and go to school for 4 more years. I'm not sure he's going to do that after playing in the NBA. Nice thought. It's a nice sound bite.
Well, that's what I'm here for. You bring the reality. I bring the nice sound bite.
That's a nice sound bite.
Hey, here's some nice numbers, too. These are the years since Pau Gasol has come to L.A., and we all remember the deal and how much attention it got when he did come here. And look, 3 finals appearances, that speaks for itself.
Well, for sure. I mean, you look at Kobe. Kobe won championships with Shaq. Magic won championships with Kareem. Kobe did not win another championship until this guy came along. Missed efficiency, 7 feet tall, soft hands, understands the game, and really took this team to another level when he came in, when they made the trade. There was so much made about that trade that I think they thought Jerry was colluded in getting him here. So there was a lot of talk about that. But Powell's just a great player, great human being, and comes to work every time he steps out on the floor.
Hey, this is my first opportunity to kind of talk a little bit about what they're doing on the floor here, and I want to ask you about it because I think for some of the people watching at home, some of them might be younger, it's good for them to see this. We've been watching as they got started here a long time stretching out and a long time doing some very basic dribbling drills, and you think NBA players, they're working on the basics when things get underway.
Well, number one, in order to play or before you play, you should go out and stretch and warm your body up. Secondly, fundamentals are the things that will carry you through in any tough situation. When you're tired, when games get down to the wire, the fundamental things are the things that work. Ball handling, making your free throws, talking on defense, the very basic thing. And I'm sure that transcends occupation. Whatever business you're in, the fundamentals are the things that will carry you through.
Now, it is interesting, though, as you come out to a training camp here for the back-to-back defending world champions to watch them just slowly dribbling a ball up and down the court and going through the basics. You don't see Kobe Bryant out on the court right now. He has left, and you were saying in all likelihood we're not going to see him in practice.
Not
because of the knee surgery he had. He did have it early. was successful, but going to take it slow as he works his way back.
But his injury wasn't as bad as Bynum. I know people like to compare that. His injury wasn't as bad, but he will take his time as well. And I'm happy to see Kobe do that. We talked about him playing through injuries earlier. I've always been one of those guys that advocated him taking the time off to have surgery on that finger, to have surgery, to heal yourself. Because, again, it's more important for him to be healthy during the playoffs. And I think those injuries really affected him once the Lakers got into the playoffs last year.
Because we continue to watch what's going on at court here. Kind of reset. There's Kobe watching the action from a chair courtside. Remind you, this is real training camp, L.A. Lakers. We're going to bring you these during the course of the preseason, try to give you a look inside what goes on in NBA practice as the teams get started and underway for this upcoming season. As we look at this here, we talked about going through the fundamentals. You see the head coach, Phil Jackson, out there. What is he talking to guys about?
Watch the drill, you know, I'm not privy to be over there, be a part of the drill, but just watching the drill from here, it's a basic fundamental jump stopping, pivoting on the correct foot. Guys were cutting off of him. The next guy get it, jump stop, pivot. The other guy would come around and get the ball. So basketball, again, one of the basic fundamentals. What's your pivot foot? Jab step right and left. And that drill was a pivot drill to understand which foot was your pivot foot.
Now, Kobe's sitting out because of the injury. How hard is it, honestly, for some of the guys who have been around 10, 13 years to have to go through these drills every year and go back through? Because I'm sure they're the same things they go over time to time
again. Let's talk about training camp, period. I mean, those guys want to sit out training camp. So he's not stressing right now. But if the time comes when the game starts, if he has to sit out and miss some games, then he'll be a little upset about it.
All right, well, we are honored now to be joined by the general manager of the Los Angeles Lakers, Mitch Kupchak, and thanks for stopping in and chatting with us as things get underway here. Congratulations, first of all. It's my first opportunity to say congratulations on the back-to-back. You must be excited about getting ready to go for that three-peat.
Yeah, it's a wonderful accomplishment, you know, for this organization. It's a difficult accomplishment. Yeah, in this day and age with 30 NBA teams and the length of the season and the injuries, so to win two championships in a row, you know, we're ecstatic about it, and a lot of changes in the NBA over the summertime. You know, we've made some changes as well, so we're looking forward to the beginning of the season.
Well, Mitch, because of the way this team has, I guess when you win in championships, you're never going to build your team from the draft. What is usually your plan and how to help make this team better? What do you do, or how do you sit down and plan it out to make moves that will make this team better?
Well, a lot depends on, you know, how the season ended, you know, and how your players are aging. And we do have some players that are aging. You know, as you know, Derek is, you know, an older player now. Kobe's still, you know, incredibly effective, but he's not as young as he once was. So you evaluate your team, and, you know, if you're winning, you like to keep the core intact. And I think that's what we've done the last two or three years. You know, also, if you're winning, you don't want to get too complacent, so you do want to make some changes as well.
Talk about some of those changes. First of all, what you were able to do through the draft and the players that you picked up and what you think about them.
Well, the draft was unusual for us this year. We had two second-round picks, Devin Ebanks from West Virginia and Derek Character were two players that we didn't think would be available in the second round, and we signed them to contracts. It's premature to say that they'll make our team. But we think there's a good chance they will make our team and at some point in time make a contribution in the NBA. So we're lucky to get two guys late in the second round.
If you could be a little specific about Character and what you saw in his play.
Well, once again, he's a player that really, very, very young, was incredibly renowned in high school as one of the best, you know, players in the country. Spent a couple of years at Louisville. Didn't go as he had expected it to go, transferred, so kind of went under the radar for a year or two, and decided to come out this year and be available for the draft. We liked the size, we liked his aggressiveness, he likes to, operate in the paint, he's got good, jump hooks, so it looks like he can get his shot off against bigger players, but once again, that's an evaluation based on summer league. With training camp, and we'll know more in 3 or 4 weeks.
And what about Ebanks' skill set?
Another young player, really can get out and run the floor. We think he has a natural position as a small forward. One thing he did there, he made that shot, but that's something that he does have to continue to work on. He's a little uncanny defensively. He has a way to, get his hand in, knock a ball loose, but he can get out and run and finish, just like that. But he's a young player. And, you know, we want to see how he does in preseason as well.
I want to ask you about I want to ask you about some of the bigger picture items now. First of all, Bynum, there's been so much in the press, and you talked about, I think one of the things I saw from you was that, and I'd like to clarify it a little bit here. The doctors went in and found more than they thought they were going to find, and that leads to it. And I think you said that's not Andrew's fault. So let's kind of clarify where the team stands with this and your feelings on where Andrew Bynum is.
Well, that's not completely accurate. You know, the diagnosis, you know, which was made back in the playoffs, was correct. And I'm not a doctor.
Right.
But my understanding was it was a torn meniscus.
Okay.
And, you know, once again, I'm not a doctor. You could take it out, or you could try to repair it, sew it back in place. And those are decisions that are made during the surgery. So when the surgery rolled around in mid-July, you know, we anticipated that it would be taken out, and that's normally 6 or 7 weeks in terms of a recovery. You know, once a doctor goes in, you know, he does what he thinks is best once the surgery is in progress, and he chose to sew it back in place, which is better for the player in the long run because he's not missing cartilage.
Right.
It's better for his career, and it's better for his life down the road. The downside to doing that, you know, when you sew it in, you know, because of the blood, there's not as much circulation in cartilage.
Gotcha.
It takes a real, real long time to heal. So something that we thought would be 6 weeks, you know, now goes to 10 to 12 weeks. And that's a long story, you know, a lot more details, you know, than I can share right now. But that basically brings us to where we are today.
Right. And obviously the sooner he's back for you guys, the better. And I'm sure looking forward to having him contribute here.
Well, last year, you know, was out during training camp, and Andrew stepped in and covered for him. So this year, Powell's going to have to step in and cover for Andrew for training camp in the first couple games of the season.
Now, Mitch, how many players are teams obligated to carry, and how many you think you'll carry this year?
The most you can carry during the season is 15. You can get by with 13, or 12 if you bring guys up and back. But basically, you have to keep 13. We have 14 players under contract. My guess, yeah, unless somebody jumps out at us in camp here, is 14 is where we're going to be.
All right. Now, talking about some of those players, we talked about the draft picks. Let's talk a little bit about the guys you picked up in the offseason. You know, Matt Barnes is a guy we looked at the numbers for this team from last year offensively and defensively. Championships are won with defense, right? This is a guy who can really get in guys' faces. We know he got in Kobe's face last year and bug people defensively.
Yeah, we didn't think Matt would be available, you know, for us at that price range. You know, as you know, it went through the whole summer, and at the very end, you know, he was there and expressed an interest to come to Los Angeles. Something that was significant to us and continues to be significant is that Luke Walton's health, you know, continues to be an unknown. He's out there, I believe, right now. He hasn't missed a practice on Saturday or Sunday. I was concerned that he wouldn't be able to make
practice yesterday. He's there. I checked for you. He's there.
So you know, we just don't know with Luke and his back situation. So we thought that would be a great, you know, pickup for us to cover us at that position.
And Ratliff?
Well, once again, you know, you want to make some changes. We were very pleased with DJ Benga and his contribution the last 2 years. But he's a young guy that wants to play. And, you know, the decision was made that he wanted to move on. So you look at the remaining big guys out there, and there were, you know, several, but not a lot. You know, we feel, you know, with his energy level, you know, ability to block shots and rebound, you know, he'll be able to help us. You know, we're not looking for him to play big minutes. You know, initially with Andrew out, maybe he will have to play, but we have to be careful with him in training camp because he is an older player, and, you know, although you want to get him to shape during training camp, you don't want to wear him out now.
How about Steve Blake? Again, here you get another guy who not only, I think, in terms of his skill set, but in terms of what he can do mentally for the team, a leadership role as well.
I'm not sure we're looking, you know, for leadership from him. I think we have enough of that. In terms of, you know, his addition, he's probably the most significant addition we've made, you know, this summer. And once again, I talked earlier about Derek, you know, being 36 or 37 years old. We needed some help at that backcourt ball handling position. You know, we do expect, you know, Steve to play significant minutes. He's led in a quiet way. And he's just out here conducting business. You know, he sat down after practice the other day with Phil on the court and then just, you know, spoke for 45 minutes about the offense. He's diligent, works really hard, and doesn't try to do things, you know, spectacular
plays
or fancy.
Within himself.
He plays, the game to make players better. And, in terms of scoring, we think he can make open shots. We think he'll make the right play. We're not looking for him to score big points, just like we're not looking for Derek to score big points.
Go ahead, Don.
No, I was just thinking about leadership. You don't want him for any leadership, man.
He's a point guard. He's a point guard. I figured he's got to be some kind of a leader on it.
We got a bunch of guys. We got one guy in this team, who is a leader for sure, and we look to him. And unfortunately, he's not practicing right now.
Well, let's talk about some of the competition, because I've been watching some of the moves in the Western Conference. What team in the Western Conference do you think improved or helped themselves the most in the offseason?
Well, I don't want to start ranking teams because at this point of the season, everybody likes their team going into training camp. And a lot of this is chemistry and injuries, et cetera. I think Dallas, if I have to pick a team that, is going to be towards the top in the conference, I would say Dallas, number one. I could look at all the other teams, and they kind of clustered together after that. Certainly Portland's going to be a good team this year. Phoenix is going to be another good team. I don't want to continue to name teams, but I think Dallas is the one team that has the confidence and the experience, and they made some additions that should make them a formidable opponent.
Norm, you want to ask him about a team in the East that made some offseason moves at any chance? I'm joking about it, but is this the quietest ever for a team in any sport that's won back-to-back championships to get underway because of what's going on in Miami?
Yeah, it's great. we won two championships, and there's a lot of media attention back on the East Coast, which is unusual. So we're happy with that. I'm not going to say I'm happy to be in the West, because the West didn't make a lot of significant changes, because that usually comes back to haunt you. But the East, you look at that conference, with Boston and Atlanta and Orlando and Miami. I like Chicago. I like Milwaukee. I don't know who the other teams are going to be in the conference playoffs, but, those teams are all formidable, and it's exciting. I'm looking forward to
it. Me too. I tell everybody,
regular season,
it's not going to be a walk in the park for those guys. There's some pretty good teams in the East.
No question about it. Well, listen, we appreciate you taking the time, Mitch Kupchak. Certainly best of luck for this season.
It's great to see you guys out here. Mark, Norman, good to see you.
Thanks very much. Mitch Kupchak joining us here for Real Training Camp, L.A. Lakers. And, yes, relatively quiet here on the West Coast. We're going to take a quick time out. Phil Jackson getting the troops ready to go. More practice, more interviews, more access for you here when we come back. Welcome back to the Toyota Sports Center. The LA Lakers beginning their quest for that coveted three-peat. Yeah, plenty of gold trophies in this building, and plenty of championships for this franchise. Practice underway here on Real Training Camp. Mark Fine alongside Norm Nixon, and we are going to focus in now on what is going on the court. Norm, we talked about it before. This is the start of training camp, so a lot of fundamental work, a lot of basic drills going on even for these advanced players.
Well, you saw them running up and down the court there. That's a great conditioning drill. They had to make a certain number of layups. Had time on the clock. You had to make a certain number of layups within that period of time. It was all sprinting. This is another drill, up and down the floor. So it's very nice to have drills that make you move up and down the court, because not only are they shooting drills, but they're conditioning drills. So it's a sneaky way to get guys in shape.
Now, you're talking about getting guys in shape. Obviously, things have changed over the years. Most of these guys work out nonstop during the offseason. I know it's not the same as basketball shape, but they're keeping their bodies in pretty good shape.
Well, you do work out. You have to maintain a certain level. I always say there's a floor you never want to go under, and you don't want to be in tip-top shape when you get here. But you come here, and then this is when you really get it together. And there is nothing you can do to get in this type of shape other than play basketball.
Taking a look at Kobe Bryant and the smile on his face, it's probably not their favorite thing to do, so he's standing on the side watching and smiling, and he doesn't have to run up and down the court right now.
Trust me, all the veterans would miss training camp if they could. And the exhibition game. You see guys want to play in the last few exhibition games just to get their timing together, because, again, 82 games, that's a grueling season.
It's a long season. And Kobe, again, if you do not know, knee surgery in the offseason went well, no complications. They expect that to be fine, and he should be ready to go. Also, though, dealing with the finger problem. I know they talked about surgery for that, decided they were not going to have surgery, but as Norm shows me the crooked fingers on his hand, that's going to be something else to keep an eye on, though. Basically, you can't operate on arthritis. I think that was part of the deal with him, is that they didn't want to. There wasn't really a whole lot that they thought it could correct, but it is something that he's going to have to adjust his game.
Well, Kobe is stubborn anyway. He didn't want to miss part of the season because he felt as though he could play with that type of injury. It had nothing to do with his legs, but it had a lot to do with his shooting ability. But again, I was always an advocate of get those things taken care of, allowed to heal as best as possible before you walk out on the court. But Kobe's a different kind of animal, man. He's a different kind of animal on this floor.
Some history, you know, I know people like to compare him to Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan, I believe, had an incident with a cigar cutter and had to change the way he shot the ball and worked his shot with his fingers. And the same thing now for Kobe as you look at him looking on during the beginning of practice here. You talk about the conditioning again and the shape.
Well, the layup. You got to run right to the layup.
How hard is it? How quickly do these guys get to a point where they're ready to play regular season NBA basketball?
Well, you got to remember, in training camp, you're going to go twice a day. After you go twice a day for 4 or 5 days, you'll be in pretty good shape. Then you have to take it out on the floor and play against other people, because once you throw adrenaline in that mix, you have a tendency to get tired a little faster. So, again, after 4 days, these guys will be in pretty decent shape. 4 days of twice a day.
4 days of twice a day.
Yes.
Right. And this is a team we heard Mitch Kupchak talk. They are, you know, as they make some changes on their roster, there are players on this roster, some of their bigger name players, who are getting up in their career. Kobe, of course, Derek Fisher, Pau Gasol, some of the guys who aren't going to maintain their shape and are probably going to need a little bit of a blow during the course of the season.
Well, you talk about Radif as well. They expect him to come in and give them some good minutes. But, again, Phil is one of the best at pacing himself. They have some good young talent out here. You heard Mitch talking about Ebanks. I had an opportunity to talk to some of the coaches about him. Same skill set as the Trevor Ariza. They think he's a little more fine-tuned offensively. Character, they say just a rebounding machine, had the ability to do a double-double in the summer league, but a guy they expect to do some great things. Blake, we see running up and down the court, and they're hoping that Luke Walton can get healthy and give them a few minutes. And he's moving pretty well out on the floor right now.
Yeah, you see Luke Walton moving up and down the court. That was something. It was actually pretty funny to watch Kupchak turn and look behind him to see, is Luke on the court today? I'm not even sure, and that's the way it's been with him.
He said something that I like a lot. When you keep your core together, you keep the core group of guys that won the championship together. You look back to the Chicago team. Those guys did not allow that Chicago team to stay together. They broke that team up when I thought they might have had one more run at a championship. So
nice,
Mitch,
I
give Dr. Gus credit as well. They're doing a very good thing here. Keep your core together, just add on the core. And because this team wins so much, it's very difficult to build your team through the draft. You have to have very smart scouts out there, because they picked up two guys, I think, in the draft that have a great chance of making this team.
Again, we've got a couple of these guys mic'd for you here today, so there's a reason why you are hearing practice so crisply and cleanly behind us here. Ron Artest has a microphone. Sasha Bujicic has a microphone on for us as well. Talking about the additions, you know, we kind of joked about the whole Miami thing and this team not getting a lot of attention, but look, you're looking at a team that's won back-to-back championships, and I think if it were not for the Miami situation, people would be looking like, are you kidding me? Because I think these pieces that they've added are strong pieces.
Well, when you poll most people, they think Miami's just going to walk up and get the championship. It's not going to happen like that. They do have a very good core with Bosh, James, and Wade. Those three guys average over 80 points, 20 rebounds, and 16 assists between them. But you still have to have depth, and you still have to have big men. That they don't have. They did a good job in adding Juwan Howard and Mike Miller. But again, you need those big guys. They have McGlure and Nagoskis, but they're not dominant guys that can play down low. When you compare them to this Laker team with a Bynum and a Pau Gasol, you go up and you look at Boston now. You know, they added Jermaine O'Neal. They added Shaq. Those are some big bodies. Orlando. They still can't. They don't have an answer for Howard. So the front line is not as strong as you would like it to be. You look at Bosh. Yes, he's 6'11", but he's light. He's not a big power player. So, again, that's going to be one of their weaknesses.
Well, Phil Jackson talked about the fact that individuals don't win a championship. It is very much a team game, and he's in midseason form. He's already taken a few shots at the East Coast before training camp even got underway
he
here.
He screamed at us earlier, didn't he?
Yeah, yeah, he was. He was telling us to quiet it down over here in the corner for sure. Talking about that team basketball, what they have in Boston, I think that would be the other team people will look at near the top, you know, and adding Shaq to that. Were you surprised to see that? It's funny because so many people gave Miami a hard time with these three guys kind of, you know, people use the word colluding to go play together, but and how it wouldn't have happened back in the old days. Well, Shaq was a guy who was a Laker and was so known for playing here, and now he's going to play for Boston. I mean, and how it wouldn't have happened back in the old days. Well, Shaq was a guy who was a Laker and was so known for playing here, and now he's going to play for Boston. I mean, it's almost like, you know, you can't believe a guy would go do
what
that.
What is he, the Big Leprechaun? Come up with his nickname? I like the Big Leprechaun. You know, Shaq is such a fun-loving guy. You have to like him. But in order for Shaq to be real effective, he needs to really get himself in shape. I think the last few years he's not gotten the type of conditioning that he's capable of if he spent the offseason working out. He did a decent job, I thought, in Phoenix. He got down. He got a little light there. In Cleveland, he never turned that corner. But I've heard he's dedicated himself this summer. He's a lot lighter. And if Shaq can lose some weight and get himself in condition, he could be a big help to this Boston team.
And it's definitely going to be interesting to see him in that Celtics green. That is for sure something that will be really strange for Lakers fans, no doubt. You know, Paul Pierce actually had his high school jersey retired here in Inglewood, and he was here not long ago in L.A. talking about the addition of Shaq and how excited he was about it. And, again, another thing a little out of sorts, a guy like Paul Pierce, known for being a Celtic, getting a jersey retired in Los Angeles. Of course, albeit at his high school, but his jersey was retired in L.A.
Well, he's a local guy. Yeah. I remember Paul from high school and playing in the gyms with him. He was a young guy. I was still playing at those times. So I remember playing with him and also when he went to Kansas. Very good player and really surprised me because I didn't expect him to play as well as he did once he got into the NBA. And, again, he walked in from day one consistently 20-plus point scorer per game and with a lot of heart.
Let's see if we can listen in here to what they're going to do in this drill.
Ball swung and loop. Right on catch, all right? You're dropping down. Who's guarding this man?
Fish the heck. Fishes.
He's two passes away, so B is right here where he should be. All right? You're in here now. All right? 2.9 now. Okay? Because he is what? One, two, three passes away, all right? So what we're going to do to start out here is just swing the basketball. Here. All right?
So if you take a look at this drill, basically what this drill is, it's a defensive positioning drill. When you're one pass away from the ball, Shannon Brown has the ball now. See Derek Fisher now. He's one pass away, you drop. When you're two passes away, you need to be two men away from the ball. So it's a defensive positioning drill. That's what you're watching.
I got you.
Weak side dropping when the ball's in the opposite corner.
Whoa.
You see Artest now dropping. Artest should be in the middle for 2.9 and back out.
You got him. I got ball.
The other basic fundamental about defense, you have to talk on defense. I have the ball. You're by yourself. Watch your hip right. Watch your hip left. So this is basically a fundamental defensive drill.
So, again, I'm going to go back to you on this as they switch the players and go back through what we believe will be the same drill.
Yeah.
When you're close two players away from the ball, you've got to collapse two, more and get ready to go two, over and help.
A general rule is if you're one man, if you're one pass away, you're one man away. If you're two passes away, you're two men away.
Right.
So that's a general rule. Now, that varies a little bit depending upon the talents of the individual player, but that's your general rule that you play with. When you see the ball in the opposite corner, you'll see the guy guarding the guy in that far corner all the way up under the basket.
Right.
He has no need to be hugging his man.
Like that, yeah. You see Odom there shifting in the lane back and forth.
Now he's on his guy, and you see the rest of the guys dropping. Ball guy on his man, and you hear a lot of talking.
And this all changed when the zone defense came into play, too, in terms of how far you could be away from.
Well, you can't break the plane or how long you can be in the lane. You have to be on the you can't break the plane at the basket when the ball is opposite.
Come on, right on catch, right? You win. Right on catch, you want you to be there. but if you're already on the strong side from initial.
So you can deny me. That's your man catching that.
Thank you.
Now, what's probably different, I'm not sure if training camp still structured the same way as when I was going to training camp. You'd have one practice that would focus heavily on defense, and then the other practice would focus more on offense. I'm seeing they did their conditioning drills earlier. Now they're focusing on defensive drills. Let's see if most of these other drills would be defensive drills.
Personnel out here.
It's character up under the basket. There's character under the basket. Matt Barnes.
Yep. See Walton out there as well. You know, I spotted character and I want to make sure I had the right guy as he was walking on the court, because you could hear in the background Coach Person is mic'd up for us as well. He and Ron Artest were talking to character while he was off the court about the drill and giving him tips on and some help into what they wanted him doing. You see the coaching staff working with him right now.
And again, a lot of have to do with your defensive philosophy. Some people's philosophy is to push everything to the middle. Some people would be to push it to the baseline and trap when you get to the baseline. And that'll vary from coach to coach.
This is a fun part of what we get to do here with Real Training Camp, though. I mean, we're getting to peek inside what goes on with an NBA team as they get started. And that was a great moment there as Person and Artest were working with character off the court, and then he steps on the court, and sure enough, going right back at it. The older guys, the veterans, working with the younger guys and making sure they understand where they're supposed to be and what's going on.
Those are secure veterans, because normally a guy coming after your job, you don't want to help him that much. So you watch them now, they're breaking that plane because they're going to trap on that corner. The guy on the wing is going to force this guy baseline. Character forcing baseline. You see Luke Walton broke the plane of the court. So basically they look like they're going for a trap in that situation. That's why they're forcing them baseline side.
Again, we get a switch. Odom with the ball there. He's a guy that's going to be interesting to watch this season, Norm, in terms of, you know, again, he's a veteran, been around for a while, went through that FIBA tournament, got a lot of playing time.
Well, got a lot of playing time at center.
At center, right, but in terms of how his body holds up now.
Well, he's an older guy, but again, he doesn't have to log those long minutes during the regular season. He's not playing 35, 40 minutes unless someone gets hurt. Now I think he'll play more minutes because he's going to be without Andrew Bynum. So he'll log more minutes now.
In the early part of the season.
In the early part of the season. And once Bynum gets back, you'll see his minutes increase a little.
We look at Phil Jackson here. One of the things we've got to talk about during this, the course of our show here today, is that this could be the last time he goes through this process, and it's certainly going to, it's going to be interesting to watch during the course of the season, see how he reacts and how much, if he looks at things a little bit differently.
Well, I think he looks at them differently, but it's hard to walk away from a championship team. I mean, if you had asked me to bet whether or not he would come back this year, my money would have been on he's coming back. If this team wins another championship, it'd be very hard for Phil to walk away from that. I know he's saying that this is his last season, but no. if this team wins,
you're not alone in that belief. There have been a number of people who have said the same thing. Of course, when he did make the announcement, you know, I'm looking forward to coming back for one more year with the Lakers. People kind of read into that.
Well, that's right, Sasha is
stay there.
That is Sasha.
Walk. Good job, Fish. Walk.
Yes, Sasha Vujicic, one of the guys we have mic'd, and now you know why. Huh? He's he's definitely a vocal guy on the floor. No, I was saying, you know, I think that Phil definitely did. He kind of left the door open a little bit, and guys have talked to him during the course of press conferences, even since he returned here, about the fact that you know, this is going to be his last year, and he hasn't said it for sure it is, also hasn't said for sure it isn't, but he's led people to believe that it is probably going to be his last year. But yeah, the door is certainly open there, and a lot of people have said the same thing you did, Norm, which is if they win the championship, might be a good shot, and you're going
to
see him again.
I'll be more inclined to believe if they win, he'll be back.
Well, there you go. So you wonder if the opposing teams will start giving them gifts and stuff if they go through that whole routine at the end of the season.
It'll be very, no, I don't think they'll do that. I think they'll wait for him to really announce that he's done. He'll have an opportunity to go through the league.
Drills continuing here at Real Training Camp, L.A. Lakers. Some of the new faces, we're enjoying getting to see them go through the steps here. Of course, there's Ron Artest. See Lamar Odom looking on in the background there. Work on a defensive drill here. We talked about Phil Jackson, and Coach Shaw is the guy that a lot of folks are saying might be the one to step in.
I think Phil had said he would love for Coach Shaw to be the one to take over if he does retire, because I think what that does is it guarantees consistency as far as offense, consistency on the bench, someone that all the players are familiar with. And I think Brian does a great job with the team. I would be very happy to see him stay in that position.
Yes, sir. Wow. Same group or different group?
Back-to-back champs going back to basics. Real Training Camp, LA Lakers. We're going to take a quick timeout. More mic'd action after this. As if on cue, the Lakers transition to another drill. We are at Real Training Camp, LA Lakers. Mark Fine alongside Norm Nixon. They just finished a defensive drill. Kind of working on matching up and making sure guys knew where they were as the ball moved around the perimeter on defense. And what are these strange apparatus they're bringing out for us now, Norm?
That's the toss back. That came out when I was a young guy playing basketball. You just bounce it off of. Let's see what drill they do. You see the big guys on the opposite end, the guards, and a couple of small forwards on the end there. and let's see what drills they're going to do. You can do ball handling drills off of these, passing drills, or you can hit it, let it toss it back to take a shot off of it. So let's see what drill they're going to get into.
Coach Phil Jackson talking to some of the players underneath the basket next to one of these toss backs. And interesting to watch him. You know, we talked about him potentially being in his final year. He's got the knee brace on. You see him limp around. I know that's one of the reasons why it might be his final year. His health, he talked about the long plane trips back and forth across the country, has an effect on him.
Well, he's actually moving better now than he did at the beginning of last season. I know he tossed it out there last year that he wanted to coach only the home games, but I don't think that went over too well with the front office.
Yeah, that's they're going to need him for all 82. And you can see the brace on the left knee there.
We should ask Mitch about that while we had him here. Was it possible for him to coach just the 41 home game?
Or I could ask him how much leadership they needed out of him.
Point guard, no leadership. That was new for me.
Tell you what, you talked about being strong and being secure, and for veterans who are secure, you can also talk about leadership when you bring in a point guard like that who's got experience, and you really don't need any leadership.
I played point. I mean, I don't understand how a point guard can be the leader. You're the guy with the basketball all the time. You'll be initiating the offense. But in Phil Jackson offense, you really don't need a point guard. Most of the guys bring the ball up court. It's more about them setting up in their triangle than having a point guard to run the court. But you have to have leadership from somewhere on that floor. And I think that's what they're speaking to. If you got Lamar Odom on the floor, you have Kobe Bryant on the floor, those guys are going to be your leaders.
And I think what Mitch's point was, they didn't bring him in because they needed a leader. I think that's what he was trying to say. Let's listen into what they're trying to do with this drill.
Get the ball back to the guard. After you've done that twice, I'm going to ask you to make a baseline reverse pivot or an outside turn and drive baseline and take a jump shot. Okay? All right, here we go. 3 minutes, just 3 minutes, guys.
Watch your shirt. You going to put the time there or no?
You ready?
You got me?
They're just using it as a toss back to shoot the jump shots off the move. Again, what this works on is your passing and also catching and shooting off the move.
Now, I'm going to take a guess here, but you can tell me if I'm correct. If there's a player there receiving and giving back, that player can be forgiving. You make a bad pass to the player, he can catch it if it's up higher, if it's down low, and still get it back to you. Here, you've got to make the right pass because this thing isn't going
to
be as forgiving.
You have to make a pinpoint pass to get it right to you, and you just catch it and shoot off the move.
Vujicic there. Again, is wearing a microphone for us today here on Real Training Camp. Trey Jones. See Matt Barnes. Derek Fisher.
There you go.
And now I'm watching their two Parsons' drill. After the guard shoots the basketball, then he's going down, hitting the big guy coming off a down pick for a jump
shot. There you go.
A good drill, you don't have a lot of guys standing still, do you?
You don't have a lot of guys standing still. Constant movement. And when you're dealing with 17 guys, the thing you have to be careful of is not to have guys standing around too much. These guys get stiff that way. So it's better to keep a drill that's a continuation drill so everybody's involved and everybody's constantly moving so you stay warm. And when you're dealing with older bodies, you want to keep these older bodies warm.
Inside reverse pivot. Into the court. Inside reverse pivot. Inside reverse pivot, Russell.
Out plan.
Inside reverse pivot, Andrew. Russell, inside reverse pivot. There you go.
There you go, big fella.
How's that?
Outside.
Two outside. This is your outside move, which allows you space to pass the ball, so show the ball and drive. All right, front turn, that turn, rear turn, inside your first tip. Those four. There's four moves over here, other things close to. Same four different terminology, is a drop step instead of rear turn. It's a drop step. Okay, now we're ready to go 3 minutes down. Last minute, or last 30 seconds, I'm going to ask the wings to reverse and the guards give use to middle penetration. So this time when the guard comes down the court, rather than being in the pro lane, which is here, the guards are going to be moving outside here. This guy leans, middle penetration. That means reverse on the guard. We're just going to hit him on the move, take a jump shot. So the guy's waiting in line, prepared to step out of the way.
Talked about fundamentals. This is just a fundamental footwork drill. He had the big guys talk about inside pivot or outside pivot, swinging the ball through. Again, just basic fundamental basketball.
Same sequence.
Yeah. Talked about the players and the veterans.
This way?
Yes. How much they, you know, probably struggle a little bit with coming to training camp every year dealing with the minutiae. What about the coaches? You look at a guy like Phil Jackson and obviously coming to the end of his career. I'm sure there's a part of it he enjoys, but I'm sure part of it is also tedious for him and the coaching staff as well.
You always get tedious. You can't wait for the season to start. But with a guy like Phil, you're going to your fourth three-peat. So he has a lot on his plate and a lot to get him motivated and get up for. And with the players that were on the team the last few years, they're looking to do a three-peat. Kobe wants that sixth title and the second three-peat of his career. Wherever you start out, the prize is always the championship. So initially, you want to get into the regular season. You look to be 10 games over 500. That's your first mark. You want to be 12-2 or 13-3. And you try to go 20 over that. You want to be 30-10. And once you do that, you get into the playoffs, and you're trying to get to the championship. You want the championship.
How much do NBA coaching staffs talk about setting goals and try to motivate the players when you come out at this early stage and say, hey, guys, to your point, we're trying to do something special here. We need to do these little things if we want to get another chance.
You set those goals. The first goal in my mind as a player was always to be 10 games over 500. You know, or not 10 games over 500, but you want to be that 12-2 or 22 and 12. You want to get to that mark first. That's the first mark you want to do. You go through your schedule, you look at games you think you should win, you look at games that are tough ones, you look at that tough road trip. Okay, this is a 7-game trip. If we can go 5-2 on this trip, that's a great trip. So you have to try to beat the teams that you're supposed to beat. That's why coaches get upset. You have a team that you're supposed to beat, and you let that game get away from you, then it put pressure on you. And then you start looking for your positioning in the playoffs. You want home court. You want that home court advantage in the playoffs.
You talk about incremental goals there, and I know Phil Jackson talked in his press conference yesterday, I believe, that about the fact that it is an enormous undertaking to try and win another championship, and you really do. It's a cliche, but one game at a time, small goals at a time, and not looking so much at the big picture. Another question about Phil. You've covered this team for quite a while since your playing days here. Is he a guy, some coaches give guys tasks in the offseason. I want to see you get better. You know, give me 5% more from the free throw line. Give me another half a rebound per game. Is he a guy who kind of gives guys tasks?
I don't know if they give you tasks, but if you're a guy, you're shooting 65% from the free throw line, they're going to tell you, you need to work on your free throw shooting. That's usually concentration and repetition. A guy that didn't shoot the ball very well,
you need to work on
your shot this summer. A guy that wasn't a great defensive player, there are drills you do, but get in shape. I want to see you work hard on the defensive end of the floor. Now with your young guys, you usually put them in the summer league. And those guys, you'll probably have a better plan. You need to work on your shot in the summer league, or you need to work on this during the summer league. And with guys like Kobe, get away from the game for a moment. Don't do anything. I want you to just go and rest and then come back slowly.
Let's listen in some more to this drill as they finish this one off here.
Ball. Oh.
As if on cue, they're going to work on some free throws here. We talked about that, the importance of that.
Next two high
and we're watching some of the guys in the coaching staff in the drill breathe pretty hard.
Brian Shaw being given a hard time by Mr. Nixon here. A little huffing and puffing going on. What is it about him that has everybody's attention on him as the potential next coach? I mean, there are a lot of assistant coaches that have been around as long as he has. What is it that separates him?
Well, I think what's up, number one, he was a point guard. You know, I'm biased to that, which means he had to understand the offense. He has to understand how to get the best out of players. As a point guard, you have to know where guys like to get the ball. You have to know guys' strengths and weaknesses on the court. It's like if I'm playing with a guy, I know he's a shooter, I want to give him the ball in places where he can do something with it. So first, that understanding of the game. Then I think the rapport with the players. I think he's kind of nonsense with the players. He has fun with them.
Show them my shirt, registration, license plates.
And he's been around.
He's like, I got to call this
in. And I think all the players like him. I think the coaching staff like him. So.
A lot of smiles here at the Toyota Sports Center as things get underway for the LA Lakers. It is real training camp, Lakers style. We're going to take a timeout. More after this quick break. Welcome back to Real Training Camp, LA Lakers. Here at the Toyota Sports Center here in Los Angeles, actually El Segundo, California. Mark Fine, Norm Nixon, and we're now joined by Brian Shaw. You huffing and puffing a little bit? You're out there working out with you guys.
A little bit. 44 catches up to you quick.
What do you think? We talked about the fact that obviously Norm was joking about for the veterans, it's tough to get out here in the first early days. No, nobody loves this part of training camp, but you guys got to go through even the smallest fundamentals for these guys, get them ready for the season.
Exactly. You know, and it's 15 years starting for Kobe and Derek Fisher, and they've gone over these fundamental things that we're doing on a daily basis throughout their 15-year career, you know, when they've been here. So something that we do, just the most basic things, because it's a lost art. Just footwork and being able to feed the post and the proper passing techniques and things like that.
Now, out of all the new rookies, now which guy has been the most impressive right now between Ebang's character and the guys you've seen?
Well, I think both of them have been impressive in different ways. You know, character has been a beast on the boards. He goes after everything, and his body, you know, is in play. So he puts that weight on guys. He knows how to use it. He knows how to get his shot off, but he's relentless after the boards. Devin Ebanks, you know, gives us a different gives a different ability in terms of he can get out, really run the break. He's a good defender. He knows how to use his length. And he's shown some touch, being able to post up and hit a little turnaround, you know, 15-foot shot as well.
I've got to ask you about the point guard, too, and picking up a guy like Blake. And how much have you already talked to him, and how much of an addition you think he's going to be for this team?
Well, I think he's going to be great for this team. He's a guy that, you know, really can pass the ball, looks to get the ball ahead, doesn't make a lot of mistakes out there on the floor. And I think he kind of sealed his fate with us when he was with the Clippers last year towards the end of the season. He had a big triple-double against us when they defeated us. And so he's been a thorn in our side for a long time, and now it's nice to have him on our side.
Well, we were talking about Phil, too, and Phil has made you the heir apparent to this job. They talk about it all the time. What do you think about that? I know you don't want to talk about it too much, but what do you think about that?
Well, I don't really think about it. You know, what I'm fortunate to come to work and be able to learn from somebody that has so much experience and has had so much success. So I'm just trying to be a sponge and soak up as much as possible and, you know, let everything else kind of play itself out. You know, I'm in a great position. But I want to be, right now I'm an assistant coach, and I want to be the best assistant coach that I can be.
Yeah, they asked me earlier, why did I think you'd be a good coach? I said it had something to do with you playing point. You had to understand everything.
Well, definitely. No, coming from a past point guard, you know that, you know, we're an extension of the coach out there on the floor, and you got to know where everybody else is there out there. And so, you know, your entire career that you play point guard, you're basically a coach out there on the floor.
Well, whether it's going to be with this team or with another team, you ultimately, let's say, wind up as a head coach. Talk about, you said you learned so much from Phil Jackson. Aside from the fundamentals, you know, and the X's and O's, what other, give us one or two things that he's taught you about how to run a team and be a leader.
Well, one of the things, and not everybody's afforded this ability, or, you know, is able to do this, but his patience, you know, for one thing. He's at an even keel all the time, never too high, never too low. And that translates to the team. So in situations, in critical points of the game, you don't see him shaking and nervous when he's, you know, when it looks like we're in a bad situation. You know, he's calm. He says, this is what we're going to do. And the guys feel that confidence, and they go out there and put that out there on the floor. I think also the fact that guys have been around the game for a long time. So when it comes to the X's and O's, everybody's pretty much the same when it comes to that. But I think what he's done has been able to blend different personalities and egos and make them work together. And so, you know, that's one thing, just being able to manage guys off the court and the things that they bring on the court, and make them understand that once they're between these lines, we don't worry about anything else out there. We're all together on this court.
Good.
What the stuff going on the East Coast? How I mean, we got to ask you about that, because I keep saying, I've been giving the same line to everybody. This has got to be the quietest beginning to a season for a back-to-back defending champ in the history of sports. Forget just basketball and any sport. For a team that's this good, has made these kinds of additions. Have the guys been talking about it at all? You get a kick out of that?
You know, no, they haven't really been talking about it at all. And I think it's a great position for us to be in terms of let them get all the attention right now. You know, we're going to obviously start the season most likely without Andrew Bynum. You know, Kobe's coming off a knee surgery. You know, so we have some guys that'll be out. So we kind of want to, you know, kind of slowly get ourselves into a rhythm this season. And what the additions of those teams made on the East Coast, it piqued the interest of everybody, you know, all NBA fans around the world now. So everybody's going to be honing in on what they're doing over there, and we're going to be quietly doing our business over here on the West Coast.
Coach, appreciate you taking the time. We're going to let him get back to it. You know, Norm called him over.
Oh, yeah,
he came right over here.
Man, I want to say, look,
best of luck.
Congratulations. Good luck on this three-peat, and hopefully next year when we're sitting here, you'll be the head man.
I appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
All right, we're going to get back to showing you some practice action now. Let Coach Shaw get back out on the court. Appreciate him taking the time and stopping by. And real training camp, L.A. Lakers. And this is, look, when you tune in, this is the kind of things you're going to see. We're going to have an opportunity to talk with different individuals. And we were talking about Brian. He was at the basket working on free throws with some guys right next to us. And Norm called him over. He was nice enough to chat with us for a little while. And you know, we should point out, Phil said yesterday during a press conference that he really, you know, everybody's kind of assuming that Brian's going to be the heir apparent, but he was careful to say he's very happy about all of his coaches, and they all bring talents, and they, a number of them have potential futures as head coaches in this league. And then ultimately, it's the front offices. I think his point was, that's not going to be my choice. It's the front office's choice.
Ultimately,
yeah. Take a look. a look at coaching staff as another drill goes on here. Oh, yeah. At the
when you look at his staff, Jim Clemens has been with him longer than anybody.
Yep.
Jim did have an opportunity to coach at Dallas, even though it was brief. But he's a guy that understands the system, understands Phil's philosophy as good or better than anybody else that's on his staff. So it will be Dr. Buss's decision along the structure. But I'm hopeful it'll be Brian. I like Brian. I think he's done a great job with this team. He played here, and it will be just great seeing him get an opportunity to coach this team.
I asked him what he learned from Phil, and you hear those management skills. I think anybody who's ever been in the workforce of any kind of job knows how tough it is to be a manager. And when you talk about coaching, yes, the X's and O's is one part, but managing those personalities is obviously as much, if not more important, a part of that job.
As a former player, I think managing the players is the biggest part of that job. Because when you have guys like Kobe Bryant and Michael Jordan, those guys are definitely capable of winning games. But when you mix in a Ron Artest and a Dennis Rodman, guys with those type of personalities, how do you get all these guys to buy into the team concept and playing together for the same goal, not go too crazy off the court? So I think great coaches are great managers, and that is one thing that he does extremely well.
And nothing against Adrian Dantley in Denver, but we saw when you got a team with George Karl that was so used to how he managed those personalities, it's very tough. And of course, he's one of the all-time greats. You take him out and try and stick somebody in for the first time right in the middle of the season as they're going into the class. Very, very tough. And it wasn't necessarily an X's and O's things. It's, hey, you've got your leader, the guy who's everybody's turned to, and you take him out. The leader for this team, of course, Phil Jackson, continues to be.
Well, it's always personality. I play with AD. He's a very quiet player. So I can imagine his personality changing that much as a coach. He was a guy that just got it done out on the floor, didn't talk a whole lot, didn't have a whole lot to say.
Well, you talk about being even keeled. That's what Brian Shaw said. Very important to be even keeled, not get too high and too low. Boy, there's a couple of coaches, Norm, I can think who didn't go by that same philosophy, not getting too high. To see some clipboards getting slammed and some guys yelling and ranting.
Any of them have championships?
Phil.
Does any of those guys have championships to slam those things down? Think about it.
No, very good point. Very good point. Hey, Phil Jackson, I'll tell you what, this is a guy who is very different in the way he approaches a lot of what he does.
Life.
He talks a lot, yes, but brings that to the team. Talks about loving each other, talks about, a different, look, they meditate together as a team, a completely different viewpoint from what is thought of historically as a professional sports coach. Pick and roll drill going on here, Norm?
Yeah, exactly. And as Brian said, the first thing he said when he sat with us, he said, did you notice that we do just basic fundamental stuff? Because it's a lost art form, and it's so true. When you watch a lot of these teams, fundamentally they do so many things wrong, and it's amazing. And my philosophy had always been, I thought the NBA got really young at one time. They were taking so many guys out of high school that a lot of those guys just weren't fundamentally sound. So when you watch games, the teams, as a result, were doing so many things that went just totally against fundamental basketball. Like you can see now they're getting away from that now. They're starting to take guys out of college again, not as many high school guys.
Talking about a banana cut there instead of straight pies. Talking about a guy taking an arc, I guess, to the basket instead of a straight line, right?
Exactly. Well, when you're cutting off the pick, it's more rounded cut when you're coming off the pick. You're passing and cutting off every getting in and taking a jump shot. A very simple drill. I mean, every drill we've seen so far this morning, they've just been very basic, simple, fundamental drill, pick and rolls. Pivot foot, inside pivot, outside pivot, nothing that complicated.
Even before we started, very basic dribbling the ball up and down the court. Very basic stuff.
Allow our guard to make that penetration. Penetrates, it's going to open up like this. If this goes down and you penetrate the all-purpose pickup throw, our one-count pickup throw that we've worked on before, he's going to look over his outside shoulder and loop, and then come back and make an inside pass. Pick the ball up, put it on the outside shoulder, and drop the ball off. It's a little timing action going on there.
That's a real interesting part of this here, Norman, and folks at home, fans may be seeing that even the direction in which a player is looking before he makes a pass is something that's thought about in practice.
Pick and rolls, you have to roll toward the basketball, you're cutting off, you look to see where your big guy is once he starts rolling.
You know what I mean?
A nice delivery pass. They're looking off. We saw Sasha look from the right, the outside shoulder.
He's looking outside.
On the left side, you look on the outside first, then you look on the inside.
You know what I mean? Doesn't matter, right? Which one you want. If you want. Yeah, you got it like that, yeah. Gotta go around him.
Have a series of actions to go off. This is important for us to just have this aspect. Right? How? Drew and Russ run in and play post. Another post and Thiel.
Yeah.
Alternate post spots on both sides. Alright, so one's off, two are on.
And usually, I'm not sure, but usually when coaches break drills down this much, this is usually a part of the overall offensive scheme.
Right.
So you can believe in a triangle. These are the same moves that you'll see the guys make within their offense. So when these things are drills and you're drilling them every day, when you see this situation in the game, you don't have to think about it. You're reacting. So with basketball in general, you want to take a lot of the thinking out. You want guys to be able to react. Don't think. Just play. Just react and play. Don't think about where you have to go. Think about what you're doing. Just play the game. The more you drill, the more they become second nature.
Just like practicing free throws, it's the muscle memory at another level. Now you're doing the same thing with the offense.
Exactly.
You want it to be muscle memory. You don't have to think about it. Just the more repetition, the easier it is to get it right in the pressure situation. All right, now here's the $64,000 question for us. We talked about the triangle offense, all right? You've mentioned a number of times Coach Jackson going for his fourth three-peat. Unprecedented success this guy's had with this offense. How come in a sports world that is copycat, by and large, guys have success? You see it whether it's in football with the West Coast offense or what's happened with the use of bullpens in Major League Baseball. So much copycat going on in Major League sports. Why haven't we seen more copycats with the triangle offense?
First of all, people have tried it, but if you don't have the talent to execute it, it's all about the players. If you have the players that can execute it, it's a read offense. It's offense that you have to play off your instincts, and then you have to have the certain pieces, because someone can run this offense and it's not as effective as when you have Pau Gasol, Kobe Bryant, Juan Artes, Lamar Odom, Derek Fisher running it. So it people is have
also,
tried it.
Is it also more complicated? Does it take a few years to get to
No, the there is not offense in the league.
No,
I mean,
okay.
I hear people buy into Pau Gasol learning in 2 months.
No, good point.
So it depends on the player. Some players pick up offenses quicker than other players. So I think if you're the type of player that can pick up offense, nothing will take you that long to learn.
Okay.
I think learning how to play with your teammates might take long, but as far as learning the basic offense, no, it's not going to take you that long.
Maybe also having the confidence you're going to have the same personnel year in and year out with that kind of offense. And that, you know, when you know that the team's got this kind of talent, you're not going to have as much turnover either.
Yeah, and as a coach, too, you need a guy like Kobe, a guy like Michael Jordan, when the play breaks down, and has the ability to go one-on-one and make something happen. You don't want to see them doing it all the time. When we talk about the Cleveland Cavaliers last year with LeBron, that was the one thing we thought about that team. Too much one-on-one with LeBron. One guy cannot win a game. You have to have a system that can spring guys open sometimes. So that team, I thought they depended a little bit too much on him going one-on-one.
Phil Jackson talked about that in his first book quite a bit about Michael Jordan, how as he got more comfortable with the offense, he saw a lot less of the one-on-one stuff, you know, because he gave him that liberty to go one-on-one, but he wanted him working within his offense as well. And the percentages changed as time went on with him getting more confident.
And it makes the game easier. It makes the game so much easier. When your offense can spring you open and get you some open shots, it makes it easier. If you have to break somebody down and go one-on-one all the time, it's a lot of wear and tear, and it wears you out. But if you can come off a couple of picks and just shoot some wide open shots, make it easy. Keep it simple. If you're a guy that passes the basketball when you're double team, then teams don't know how to play it. Make it simple. Kobe did a better job this year at getting his teammates off. It made the game a lot simpler for him versus trying to take everything on his own.
Well, for those people who will be critical of the NBA and talk about it being a one-on-one league, you are looking right now at a team practicing, a team that has won back-to-back championships, a team that's been as successful as any in the history of the league, and has been so not just because they've got a guy in Kobe Bryant, but because they play that team basketball, because they have been so good at working together as one unit.
You have to defend, all the time I'm out. Well, he shoots all the time because nobody on this team can play. Guys make it to the pros because they can play basketball. And given the opportunity, guys will step up. And that's what's so amazing. When you spread the basketball around, other guys will step up.
They liked that comment. They applauded it.
They did.
The team was up there
that.
Cheering for you. Very nice name.
Get other,
nice
guy,
job
get other guys
down.
Off. Spread the basketball around. 100 and some points a game. Four guys can average over 20 points. I mean, the team that I played on with Magic, Kareem, Jamal, all of us average, you know, those two, Magic and I both averaged close to 18.
Right.
And Jamal and Kareem averaged over 20. We had McAdoo coming off the bench averaging double figures. I mean, so we had five guys scoring in double figures. So the game is long enough for that to happen, but you have to be willing to share the basketball and create opportunities for other players.
It's fun listening to you talk about those teams. Is it fair to try and compare eras? You hear, you know, fans doing that all the time. How good is this Lakers team compared to the other?
It's unfair to compare eras. I think you can talk about a championship team in any era can come and compete. I mean, you can't tell me Bill Russell's teams could compete, or Wilt Chamberlain's teams could compete, or the teams I played on in the 80s could compete with anybody. And it would be very difficult to tell another guy or another championship team that your team could beat them because nobody's going for it. We was the champs because we were the best. So everybody, you know, think their team was the best team. And trust me, you wouldn't have been a championship team and one of the best if you didn't think it.
Right. Well, yeah, no,
you
that's
have
part
to
of
think it.
The confidence of a champion, right?
Yeah. I mean, even with individual players, you have to be you're a great player because you think you're better than everybody else. So, I mean, people look at it different ways. Is he confident or is he cocky? Some guys just say it. Other guys just think it and not say it. There's some guys that would say it. But all of them have it.
Let's see if we can hear what Coach Jackson's saying right now.
We're going to go through four runs, up and down, up and down, up and down. That's it. You're off. The next group comes on. Free throw shot. You're going to run three more operations, four times up and down the court, and then you're off. And then I'll change what you're going to do as you go up the court so you kind of get into what we want to see you do. All right? Has everybody got that? You got your groups? Okay. Now take your free throw line position. I checked you in the basket.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. What I want to see is the all strong arms so you're not positioned coming out on your
Chuck.
Buns.
Chuck.
So our first move.
Yeah.
I'm going to show you guys how we take the ball up, make a guard in the entry, right? You look properly coming down the court, but it's short. So come on up to the guard. No matter what the timing is, of how you're not going to see it coming in through the post, I'm going to hit it. It's going to be what we call a short. That is a half of a full sprint. So you're short. So the ball's going to be taken back out. The guard's going to advance the ball. He's going to hit our wing. Wings and take a jump shot. Right. Everybody's in the lane, we mind the ball up collectively together until it's in. You take the ball out of bounds again. You take it back, guard wings, and throw it to the wing. Wings and penetrate, lag the ball back to the guard. Guards can take a jump shot. That's what we call our sweet spot jump shot. Right. Fourth time back here, same action. Guards can take it out of bounds. Wing back to the guard. The guard's going to lay the ball back to the weak side guard, which is called the guarding spot. That guard's going to actually take the ball into the key spot, which is our operating position, organize the offense around two desks and put inside the house. Okay?
Fish. Fish, I'm running with you. We don't go one guy.
They catch you out of here. We're not going to touch you, please.
We are.
Rebound! Rebound!
This guard's going to just get a little hit for our post and bring it down to the guard. He's going to hold up.
As we're watching them run these drills, Norm, you talk about back-to-back defending champion. What Is there an area maybe that you look at this team? We saw the offensive and defensive statistics from last year, certainly defense better than offense. Is there an area you think that they're working on where they need to maybe improve if they want to get that third championship, or an area where they need to make sure they stay consistent maybe is a better word?
The number one, two, and three things are health.
Yeah, there you go.
That's the biggest one. I mean, as far as these guys understanding what it takes to win, they've won. They've been in the championship the last 3 years. So this core group of guys know what it takes to win and to get there. The biggest hurdle is going to be their health. Will Bynum be healthy? How healthy would Kobe be? And adding some of these young guys to that basic core. You have a core group of about 7-8 guys. You brought in Matt Barnes. You bring in Radliff. You bring in those guys. And so...
Well, depth, you know, inevitably some teams are going to deal with some type of injury. So when you deal with that injury, what kind of depth do you have and how well do you deal with those guys? Hey, any coach in any sport is going to tell you, you know, preface his preseason comments with, if we can stay healthy. That's
always fun. That's the biggest one. Barring that, I think this team just wants to, I don't know what area they could be better in. I mean, they made it to the finals 3 years in a row, so evidently they're doing a lot of things right. But you can always do a better job of, like, they lost leads a few times. They didn't know the way they approached the game. They didn't mentally, they weren't there all the time. So those are things that you talk about throughout the season, staying mentally tough and making sure you approach the games the right way. Don't get too confident. And knowing that now you have two championships in a row, every team's going to come after you every game. So you have to be prepared for that mentally.
Sasha Vujicic wearing the mic for us on the court right now.
That's okay, that's good. Hi. What do we got next? Go around. Hello.
Huh? Yeah.
We put that out last year. Last year we stopped back in the. We took it out. In the playoffs right now. Okay.
Thanks, Al. My bad.
Hey, didn't he take out back screen, down screen last year?
Yeah. Did he take it out?
Remember he was doing it, then he said stop. But I guess we're going back. All for this one, serious.
All right. Third time down. We're hitting our cutters. The ball comes to our first guard. He's going to cross court to that cutter because we've been using the button hook, right? Let's hit the guy that's using the button hook. Now you're making a break on it. Fourth time back, you're hitting that cutter. We're going to operate out of the fifth side of it. We just worked on it.
Well, that was only for once.
The first one, that's why I was waiting. He's right there, you know, in the middle of it.
See it on camera, but I saw them talking on the side here. You might have been able to hear it at home. Ron Artest was actually asking Phil Jackson, how Steve know the triangle so well? Was he practicing this summer? So you and I were just talking about picking up the offense, and Phil's answer was yes. But obviously, Artest impressed with the fact that Blake seems to be so comfortable in this offense already. I guess it doesn't take years to pick up, right?
No, it doesn't take years. And you heard Brian Shaw talk earlier. that Blake spent a lot of time with Phil after practice a few days, just talking about the offense and the little nuances in it.
Well, it's great here in the early going to see Ron Artest impressed with his new teammate and how easily you're taking a look at the two of them talking in there. He's probably saying, how'd you pick this up so quick? Well, let's listen in. Style after this.
A little bit.
So every once in a while I get confused when people start rambling a bunch
of plays
in a row.
Yeah.
For the most part, you know, I think I'm picking it up pretty good.
You're looking good out there. Once you got that, that's
I can see the reads kind of easy, but it's like when you start saying the action.
Yeah, that's something you could probably read anyway. You'll read it anyway.
Yeah, I just
know. But he just likes to say it.
Yeah.
But actually, that's a playbook. You don't have a playbook. He'll say it in the game, too. Same thing he's saying right there. He'll say it in the game without even drawing it out. This guy's been here 3 years.
That's interesting.
Yeah. He said, if I hadn't have been here a couple, Blake said, if you didn't hear it, if I hadn't have been here a couple weeks early, I'd be so lost right now. And Artest said, well, there have been guys who have been here years that have picked it up. So you're way ahead.
This is actually very interesting for me because I've never heard been inside of a practice with Phil explaining the offense like this and what they're trying to accomplish and do.
This is definitely a rare inside look for you. We'd like to bring you here, NBA.com and NBA TV. Real training camp with the LA Lakers. Phil Jackson, the legendary coach, as Norm has mentioned a few times, going for his fourth three-peat and working on his famous triangle offense with the LA Lakers.
Huh?
Just tuning in, just checking this out for the first time. Kobe Bryant not on the court because of the knee surgery that he had. It was successful. They don't expect any hiccups or delays in his return to the team. But in the early part of training camp here, he is taking it easy and he's out running the drills with the team.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Stop it. Still cut.
Yeah.
And get out.
We talked about the players they got in the draft. We talked about the players they picked up, free agents, players they retained, Shannon Brown and Derek Fisher. Derek Fisher, we're watching him work with Ron Artest and Paul Gasol here. Huge for them to have him back, right?
It's huge for him. I mean, we talk about Derek's age, but you don't win this championship when you don't have Derek Fisher. Big shots, the leadership, out on the floor. And I think he's the one guy that Kobe respects in the locker room. I think he's the guy that can kind of calm him down and control him somewhat. But those guys are big additions. And then Shannon Brown came in and just excited right. The whole city of Los Angeles with athletic ability, starting to learn how to play in this system. Great defensive player, doing some good things offensively now for the team.
All right, another timeout on the floor here in this drill. We're going to take a timeout, back with more real training camp, Lakers style, after this. Welcome back to Real Training Camp with the Los Angeles Lakers in El Segundo, California. Things wrapping up. Phil Jackson bringing the team in and letting them break. All right. And that is, as it is, has wrapped up here at the Toyota Sports Center. Mark Fine, Norm Nixon, now joined by Kobe Bryant, if you didn't recognize him. First question's got to be, everybody's going to want to know how you're feeling. We see the knee wrapped. How's the knee and the finger?
Doing well. You know, knee is doing, much better than it did. Than it was last year in the playoffs. So it's getting stronger. And, the finger kind of is what it is, but that's feeling good too.
Well, I want to ask you about the World Cup. How was the World Cup, man?
It was an amazing experience. I got a chance to actually sit, with the crowd and hear those Fufuzelas going crazy. It was a wonderful experience.
Good. I'm gonna get back. You asked the fun questions. Stick to the business. We're not seeing you out on the floor yet. Can you let fans at home know maybe what the timetable is with the knee? When will you be running, Phil? When you'll be back to?
When
to
it's ready, I'll play.
Okay.
Simple as that.
That means he'll be playing opening night, though. This guy. But I want him to take his time. But I noticed something very interesting about your practice. It seems like you guys go through very basic, fundamental stuff for most of the practice. Is that Phil's style, or have you been doing this since you've been here with Phil?
Since first day of camp, when he first got here in 2000, we had practices like this, and it's been that way since he's been here. He's a very fundamental coach. He preaches the basics, and he wants us to master those basics, and that's all we do.
Is that tough for veterans to come into camp and have to go through those same tedious things? I mean, I'm sure there are kids at home watching don't like doing it in their practices. At least they come see you guys go through the same thing.
After you win championships, no, it's not.
Gotcha.
You understand what gets you there.
But I will say this for veterans. Most veterans don't want to do training camp anyway.
He's mentioned that a couple of times
Phil's,
today.
Phil's camps, though, aren't that crazy. Hard. I mean, he's not, because he understands it's a long season. Understands he has a veteran group. He's never been a kind of coach that really pushes players to do all these sprints and all sorts of stuff. He'll run you a little bit, but for the most part, it's all X's and O's, and it's all fundamental work.
Well, we talk about Phil and winning championships. What is the one characteristic that you think he brings to the table that enables you guys to continue to win and play at this level all the time?
Well, it's his understanding of the momentum of the game and the basics of it. I mean, he's not a coach that's a rah-rah coach in guys' faces and trying to pump them up and motivate them. He preaches the basics and he preaches the style of play that we want to have, and he does that on a consistent basis, so the message is the same.
Now, and I know usually in the summer times you're a maniac when it comes to working out. Did you get some rest this summer, man?
Yeah, I didn't do anything all summer. I really just, that was my training.
Good.
Resting was my training. So.
Talk a little bit about the new guys. I mean, this is a team, back-to-back championships, and there's no question you guys have picked up some guys both, through free agency and also through the draft that should be good additions.
Yeah, we got some, key additions. Yeah. Obviously, Matt's a big, big part. You know, Steve Blake's one of the most underrated pickups of the offseason, bringing Derek back, obviously. Theo Ratliff, who looks does not look 37. And then obviously the rookies that we drafted. You know, we feel like they have a lot of promise as well. So we got a good group.
And that's got to be, for the veterans, that's got to be a big deal, too, in terms of rejuvenating. Look, you're trying to do something. You can't say it's unprecedented because Phil's looking to do it for the fourth time with the three-peat, but by the same token, something that's obviously very difficult, and you're not just standing pat. You're trying to make improvements.
Well, I mean, every year is a different challenge. You know, we don't try to group years together. We just approach this season as something new, something fresh. And, you know, if we win it again, if we're fortunate enough to win it again, the end result is a three-peat. But it's not something that you think about on a day-to-day basis. It's about how are you going to win this season with the group that we have.
And in talking about that, staying on that same line of thinking, what are the one or two areas you think you'd like to see this team improve on, or what are the two most important things that you think you guys need to do in order to keep winning?
It's always defense and rebounding. That's always the key for us. We feel like you know, if we do those things, we'll be fine. You know, we have enough firepower to generate offense. You know, your offense is going to struggle from time to time, but we feel like for the most part, we have guys that can step up and make contributions offensively. You know, but defensively and rebounding is what gets those championships.
Right. With Phil, you know, the conjecture is that this will be his last season. Obviously, there's a little wiggle room that's been left there. But has that changed things at all? Do you guys talk about that at all? What's the feeling around the team concerning that?
No, we don't talk about it. We don't talk about it. We, we approach it the way he's taught us to approach the game, which is take it day by day. And you don't think about what's going to happen in the future. You just think about the moment that you're in.
Okay, the moment that we're in right now is we're sitting here at Real Training Camp with the L.A. Lakers, and I've said this already several times during the course of this show. There has got to be less attention for a back-to-back championship team than there's ever been in the history of sports because of what is going on a beach on the other side of the country. What's that been like to watch that whole thing unfold and to have it really, it's had somewhat of an effect on what's going on over here?
It's been great for all of us. I think it's been great for me. You know, I like you guys. I don't really like dealing with all that hoopla. So it's been good.
Well, what do you think about? I mean, tell us a little bit what your thoughts are. There's been so much. Look, LeBron James was vilified by a lot of people around the country after his decision to go to Miami and the three of them getting together. People have used the term collusion, and it's a lot of people looking at it negatively. What's Kobe Bryant think about it?
You know, I'm happy for them. I've said this, and I continue to say this. You know, I'm happy for him because he's happy in his decision. And D-Wade, obviously, because he's had a couple years down there in Miami where, you know, it was a struggle for him. And you know, he's too talented to be in that kind of a situation. So, and Chris as well. So, you know, they're all happy. And so I'm happy for them.
Well, back to you. I'm going to talk about your injuries again. You did not want to get the finger taken care of. Why did you make that decision?
Well, the timetable for recovery was just too extensive. Mm-hmm. For me to miss a significant part of the season for an injury that I've played with anyway. It just didn't make sense for me to do that.
You making any changes, adjustments? Do you work on things in the way you're shooting the basketball and handling the basketball with the finger?
You know what? Last year was from game to game. Okay. Literally, it depends on where I got hit and how hard I got hit and how I was taped up. And this year, hopefully, it won't be that way. So far, I've been able to shoot without it being taped up. Did some things on the court yesterday, got hit on it pretty good, and it was fine. So I'm optimistic that I won't have to play with that cast.
Revisiting the championship, you lost to Boston, you beat Boston. How sweet was that to have an opportunity to go back to get the team that beat you?
No, it was great because those opportunities don't come along too often.
Getting to the finals didn't come along too often. Be able to get them back in the finals, though.
Yeah. We're very fortunate to have that chance. And, and also measure ourselves. Right. And to, for us, it was like, okay, can we face these guys and can we beat them? Because we know how they played us in 08. So it was about, how much have we improved since then? And our toughness and our execution. Can we get through this team? And, we're able to do it.
All right, I'm going to bring it. You said, can you get through that team? And I'm going to bring it back to the Miami thing because we talked about, them getting vilified and you being happy for them. That said, let's talk about the basketball side of things and what challenge you think they might present in the league and for you guys at some point.
I have no idea. I haven't played one game yet.
True statement.
Well, Coach, your coach talked about the fact that a team, it's a team game, and that's more important in looking ahead at what they may be able to provide, and that's the challenge for them, right, in terms of how competitive they're going to be.
I don't think that's a challenge for them. I really don't. I mean, for me, it's just a matter of what style of player they're going to have. That's why I can't answer your question, because
I don't know how they're going to play.
I don't
right.
think it's a matter of them gelling together. I've been around these guys with the Olympic team.
Right.
I see how well they play together. I don't think that's going to be an issue at all.
It's going to be interesting to see when you guys face off.
We'll still need big men.
Yeah, well, that's going to be part of it. Hey, and Lamar Odom's the center now, right? And he played center in the offseason. You got another big guy there. Hey, Kobe, appreciate you taking the time. Best of luck this season. Hopefully you're all healed up and ready to go when it gets underway.
Yeah, we'll see. Thanks.
All right, thanks. Kobe Bryant joining us. Real training camp, L.A. Lakers style. We're going to take another timeout. We come back more from Los Angeles. Keep it here.
Odom the drive. Oh, pretty move from Odom. Straightaway three. Got it. Odom attacks down Broadway up to the rim and scoops it in with a left hand.
Motor no good. Odom flushes the rebound up and in.
Pull up from three. Good.
Once again, nice move by Odom.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Los Angeles, California. Real training camp here in Mark Fine and Norm Nixon, now joined by Lamar Odom. And Lamar, appreciate you taking the time.
No problem. Anytime.
Congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
On the championship in the offseason and also on the anniversary. Today's
your
anniversary.
Yeah, happy anniversary,
man.
It's my anniversary today. 1 year. We made it. We made it through a year.
And
so it's real now.
Beat the naysayers.
You know what? Let's start with this because we've talked to everybody about it. This time last year, that was part of the reason things were so crazy in here as you were getting the season underway. People talking about your wedding, everybody looking at the Lakers repeat. Mm-hmm. This year, a lot of the attention on the other coast. Do you guys like it that way?
Yeah. I mean, it's cool. You know, this is L.A. You know, we're still rock stars in our own right. And, you know, we have an incredible city, you know, that supports us tremendously. And it's a great place to live and awesome place to play basketball as well.
Well, Lamar, how are you getting ready for this season? You didn't have a chance to rest. And with Andrew Bynum down, you're going to have to log a lot of minutes. How are you preparing yourself for this season?
Just mentally, staying focused, you know, I train a lot. You know, I love the box. Stay in shape, do different things, you know, off the court to stay in shape, eat a little better this season.
Eating better
this season. Just taking my time, resting.
Well, you know. I tell you, your father-in-law know a little bit about working out. That was one of the greatest athletes in the world, Bruce.
Yeah, he's there dying to get me out on a golf course. So
not on the track, the golf course. Yeah, he wants to play golf.
Yeah, he wants to play golf all the time.
Hey, talk a little bit about the FIBA experience, and we congratulated you on it and joked a little here in the beginning about your anniversary, but talk about what kind of experience that was and how much you enjoyed
it. It was awesome. You know, it was one of the most powerful things I've ever done in my life, to be able to stand there and see your flag being raised, you know, to hold the gold medal. We had a tremendous group of guys. The coaching experience was great. I'm lucky. I've been taught by Pat Riley, Phil Jackson, now Mike Krzyzewski, a little bit of Larry Brown and Greg Popovich. So I got my basketball booked to right.
And what was it like getting a rebound, giving it to those young legs you had playing with you in that FIBA championship?
They were amazing. They were tremendous. Like, they're tremendous basketball players, of course, and tremendous athletes. Of course, you know, Durant, he stayed hot the whole tournament. Russell Westbrook, Rudy Gay running out on the wings, and Andre Iguodala. It was just like, it was easy. Once we played defense, our goal was to be the best defensive team in the tournament. And, you know, once we kind of signified that, then the rest was just basketball.
A lot of talk about you playing at the center position, and people were concerned that maybe if you guys had an issue, it might be size. Talk, though, about that, and looking back at the experience now, playing in that position, did you learn anything? Did it improve your game? Did it change your outlook playing that position?
I mean, it's not too much different from the four and the five. What we were able to do and what we focused on was, you know, digging the ball out of the post. Just not letting, you know, me stand there and just, you know, fight with guys. Just digging the ball out of the post, making them kick it back out, running those guys off their shots, and just speed the game up. You know, basketball is basketball. It's a universal language. You know, it's the same all over the world.
Right. Did you talk, by the way, with Westbrook, Durant? You guys talk at all about that first-round matchup or any of the playoffs?
Not too much.
They didn't bring it up.
Not too much. But those guys were real receptive as far as receiving information. And, you know, they understand what it takes to work hard, and they want to win. And I respect that, and I can't give out too many of our secrets.
I asked Kobe the same question. And heading into this season, mm-hmm. what are the one or two areas you'd like to see this team improve in order to stay at that same level of winning you were at last year?
It's got
to
be defense, man. You know, we got guys that can score the ball, man. We got a guy that can score 81
sounds
points.
Sounds familiar. sounds a little familiar, a little you know, like what Kobe said.
You know, you got guys that, you know, Powell. You know, he's one of the best ever, maybe offensively. Big man, when you talk about how he shoots the ball out 15 feet, the way he uses his left and his right hand, how he plays the point guard position from the post. You know, and Drew, we can score the ball. Shannon Brown gets hot shots. These guys can hit shots. But to remain on top and to stay relevant, you have to be the best defensive team.
And without buying him, how does that change your role starting at the beginning of the season?
You know, I have to rebound the ball. Like you said, play a lot of minutes. You know, play tough post D, make some shots, shoot the ball well from the outside so we can spread the court and let Kobe and Powell, you know, work that post. And getting the post myself, like you always tell me too.
Well, you know what? We're going to let you get going. It's your anniversary. We got to let you go celebrate.
Yeah, I'm going to go to lunch.
Right? Appreciate you taking the time. Certainly best
congrats.
Of luck.
Thanks a lot.
Best
congrats.
Of luck this season. Thanks Lamar Odom, Los Angeles Lakers, as we are at Real Training Camp here with the L.A. Lakers. Mark Fine along with Norm Nixon. And, again, we're going to let Lamar go. And believe Phil Jackson's going to be approaching here. Yeah, we're going to let him vacate the seat because Phil Jackson will be joining us momentarily. The coach is going to let us know. You know, the one question that we haven't asked yet, and I'm going to ask, you know, might as well ask the guy who's got to do it, Norman, and that's going to be about motivating. You know, you're looking at a team that's won back-to-back championships. How is it? He's got a very rare point of view, obviously, because he's had to do it before, and now he's faced with the challenge again. How do you motivate a team and keep them, you know, going forward in terms of trying to win a championship?
I think the question is more, do you even need to motivate a team that's a championship team? Because every year you start out, you like to win championships. I can definitely speak to that as a former player. But again, when you have that tag on your back, that mark on your back, every team's going to come after you. So it's going to be a lot tougher this year.
Now you're looking at Steve Blake, one of the new additions for the Lakers. We are going to take a quick timeout. And when we come back, Phil Jackson will join us. Oh, yeah, it's a tough gig we got here, Norm. You get to live here, but another beautiful day in L.A. Cue the Beach Boys as we go to break. We'll be right back. The Lakers have won four playoff games at the buzzer during the Phil Jackson era. Here's Robert Horry, 2002 West Finals, 100-99 win over the Kings. How about 04 West Semifinals? Derek Fisher giving them the improbable 74-73 win over the Spurs. And then 06 first round, Kobe the length of the court and hitting it over the Suns. And then 2010, Ron Artest off of the Kobe Bryant miss, giving LA the 103-101 win over the Suns. That was in Game 5, and here's a look at Phil Jackson. Pro sports coaches, wow. So Scotty Bowman there in second, and Phil Jackson, who is joining us right now here at the Toyota Sports Center there, atop the list with the 11 titles. Of course, this year going for number 12, or as Norm has referred several times, four three-peats for the Los Angeles Lakers. First of all, talk about how you are feeling and how excited you are heading into this season. Why are you laughing at that?
Because he looks so excited.
Because
he looks so excited.
He looks so excited.
You know, it's just a journey that you have to start out and put the right foot forward all the time and try and do the right thing and, you know, try and make this not excitable, but a marathon race that you're going out. You know it's an endurance race. You know you've got to get out there and you've got to set a pace that's appropriate pace. You know you're going to have people pressing at you the whole time. And, you know, you have to have the stamina to make it through. And you have to have some good fortune and good luck.
You do. Coach, I was watching your practice, and one of the things I noticed, it's a very basic fundamental practice. Has that been your style, or why do you emphasize so much of the basic fundamentals in your practices?
No doubt about it, Norm. We have skills that we practice on all the time, daily, You know, you saw us do passing drill. Well, this is really the first day of practice. Yesterday, we had a practice, obviously, that was devoted to defense and trying to get hamstrings and, you know, those kind of things in shape. That was all dedicated to defensive slides and slide work and contact and how we do that. And the first practice on Saturday afternoon was dedicated to, let's see where you guys are, get out there, and I'll let you run around and play a game. And then you can tell yourself what your conditioning is. So today is our first set of two-a-days, our only set of two-a-days. So today had to be about skills and about, you know, setting up some things so that they understand that skills take precedent a lot of times over speed and, you know, quickness. And, well, quickness you never take away, but, I mean, not hurrying, having control and poise with the ball. So a lot of our offense, as you can tell, is run from a timing and a rhythm type of thing rather than just outright, you know, power or outright speed.
Right.
You talked about the fact that, you know, staying even keeled, and Brian Shaw actually said that was the thing that he's learned, that he felt was most important that he learned from you, is staying even tempered. That said, when you look at teams trying to repeat or three-peat, you know, complacency is a word that continues to come up. What are the things you try to do to keep the guys, okay, even keeled, but at the same time motivated to try and get that championship again?
Well, you know, my belief is that, you know, practice is, you know, where your palette or your canvas that you're drawing out what you want to have done. And so you have to keep that unique and interesting. It can't get boring and mundane. I think we played like 320-some games in the last three seasons. That doesn't count exhibition games, regular season playoff games. So, you know, you double that or time and a half that, you can tell that, you know, we've had over, you know, 300-400 practices with these players.
Right.
They pretty much know what's going to go on before I even say it. You know, they know the rhythm of how to do it. So, you know, we constantly throw little things in a practice to try and keep them engaged. So it's a different skill, some different activity that just brings out something where it's just not, they can do it half asleep or they can get bored with the game. You just don't want that to happen. You have to stay really tuned in.
Barring the injuries, what are the one or two areas you'd like to see this team improve, or is there an area you'd like to see improvement on from last year?
Last year we really, our bench didn't score very well for us at times and let us down in some of the ball games by not holding their end of the bargain up. We really wanted to build our bench a little bit with some, you know, experience and speed. Those are the two things. You know, Luke Walton last year was injured, played 20 games. He really was kind of a playmaker out of our bench, kind of held the glue together sometimes on our bench, and we missed him out there on the floor. So this year, in case his injury or his, you know, what he's dealing with right now isn't a problem, we have Matt Barnes that came in who's got great speed and quickness. Steve Blake is an experienced guard. He's a playmaking guard who understands, you know, a lot of the concepts of basketball already that we've been trying to emphasize. He looks like he'll be a pretty good fit. He's not particularly a scorer, but he will help guys get to the basket and score. And then Theo Ratliff is a, you know, a guy that's like an old dog in this game. He's an alligator down there. Knows how to wrestle in the lane. He knows how to block shots and. You know, he's an experienced veteran that'll give us some background. Along with that, we drafted two rookies. Now, we didn't have a first-round pick, so our rookies are both in the second round. But both of them have talent. They're both talented players. You know, maybe they can help us along. They can give us some energy and some enthusiasm and some raw power that, you know, we could use at times. I think this kid's character, who's a big, powerful kid at 6'9", you know, might have to play some center for us at times, so we have to groom him while Andrew's out to back up Theo in case we, you know, have a need for a backup center. And obviously the young Ebanks has a lot of speed and length and transition player that looks like he's going to be really fine out there in the floor in the open field.
Well, you had the whole city on pins and needles trying to wait to see if you were going to come back. Was there was one thing that changed your mind and solidified a decision, or was it all about your health?
Well, I went off to Montana without getting my final, you know, health thing, you know, finalized by my doctor. And I got a call in Montana and said, you know, everything's okay. I have some issues that have gone on for a couple of years I just have to pay attention to. and everything seemed to be all right. He said, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, you should go ahead and, you know, feel free about working a full season. I never wanted to get in a position where I was in part of a season and something would break down or something would happen physically, and I would have to say, you know, I'm going to have to back off of this year or not be able to work for a month or whatever because of a situation arose. So I felt confident then that it happened. Then I talked to Kobe, and, you know, he was like, you know, come on back. You know, we really want to try and do this again. And, you know, he's kidding me about what he talked to LeBron about. He told LeBron, go ahead and get another MVP if you want and find a city you want to live in. We're going to win the championship. Don't worry about it.
Hey, well, if anybody was concerned that the league would try and, you know, placate you, try and set things up so that it make it comfortable for you, they certainly didn't do that because your preseason schedule, you guys are going, I mean, you're going to be spending some time on a plane.
Yeah, that's not easy from L.A. to London, but, you know, we're going to do it. It's our turn, and you know, our last turn was in 9/11. Right after 9/11, we were supposed to go to China and Japan, and we got bumped because of the 9/11 situation. And so, you know, rolls back around, and you know, I knew that was coming up. I tried to dodge it, but you know, Jeannie's going over there, so I decided I'd follow her.
Well, let me ask you this: you've been a guy who's always tried to. You coach guys. A lot of what people know you for is coaching them off the court as well. Everybody knows about the books you give guys. You're going to have an opportunity to take guys overseas now. Is there anything special you plan on doing with the team over there?
We have a night with them. We know that we're going to do some things. We have a soccer game that we've been invited to go to, Chelsea versus Arsenal. That's exciting. You know, we have a lot of guys that I've gone to the World Cup. They know the soccer world. You know, it's a different venue, but it's a sport that you know, a lot of people appreciate. Kobe, obviously, growing up a lot in Europe, and Sasha and Powell are attached a lot to that. And they a lot of times get in friendly wagers on teams they'd like to see win or not win. Drew went to the World Games down in you know, Johannesburg. So, you know, there's a lot of interest in that. That should be a lot of fun for us. And obviously, when we go to Barcelona, you know, Powell's going to have full control of our whereabouts. He's going to take us.
He's in charge. Yes. You're handing the reins over to Powell when you're in Spain.
He's going
to
take us to his castle. And
I'm sure he has one.
All right, you mentioned Kobe talking about LeBron. I got to get, you know, your 2 cents on this for today. We've heard some comments from you talking about what's gone on in Miami. It certainly, I think, seems to have made things a little bit quieter around here. I imagine you don't mind that.
Well, no. I mean, you know, we're the champs, but they're favored, and I think it's a real incentive. It's a wonderful incentive for us, and we think that it's, you know, there's a lot of playing to do between now and whatever happens then. And we, you know, understand the West is just, as a conference, has been, you know, top conference for the last 10 years. Obviously, Detroit won, got a championship in these last 10 years. Who else has won from the East?
What, Miami won?
Boston won.
Boston, Miami. Boston.
That's right.
It.
That's
Boston.
It. And so, you know, the last 11 years, it's been about the West winning the championship at the NBA. So, you know, we know that our conference is going to be extremely difficult. We've got young teams coming up, and we're very much attached to what's happening in Denver. You know, the growth of Oklahoma.
Sure.
Dallas is re-signing two big guys and coming back and looking like they're going to be strong. We're concerned and wondering what's happening with San Antonio because they're going to reemerge. We're quite certain of that. Yao Ming's coming back,
yep,
in Houston.
Back in Houston.
So, you know, we know that is going to be a situation. Chris Paul's always going to be a competitive player, and he's going to lead this team in competition, as is Steve Nash. So we see this conference. Portland has kind of sailed under the radar, although this is a team that's grown
very
and grown
team
in the last couple of years. So there's a lot of teams out here to compete with.
Now, Coach, it's all about pacing throughout the season to get to the playoffs. Are you overly concerned that it might take Andrew a little longer to get back than everybody thought heading into the season?
Well, you know, annually, looking at Andrew's, you know, seasons, you know, he usually comes out, he usually has a pretty good start in November, but his real time when he's been the best player that he's always shown has been December and January. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it usually takes him 2 months to really get that stamina and the rhythm and the game and the feel, and he's had his real impact times, you know, 2 months into the year. So knowing that and knowing he's going to not be able to start, you know, weight bearing activity until the end of October, you know, can a month get him back out on the court? Can 6 weeks put him to the place he wants to be? Is it going to take 2 months? You know, my feeling is it's probably going to take him until, you know, the end of December before he's really, you know, the Andrew that's as active and as dominating in the middle as he can be. So we have to prepare ourselves for that.
And it was good to see Powell get some rest. Now Kobe's going through his little injury thing. When do you expect Kobe to get back?
I've been talking to Kobe about just pacing himself in the preseason. You know, obviously we want him to play in London and Barcelona. You know, these people want to see him on the court. So, you know, whatever. You know, I said, you know, 12, 16 minutes maybe at most, you know, get out there and play a little bit. Barcelona, he still has Juan Carlos Navarro. He remembers from the Olympic Games that got a lot of points on him, so I'm sure he's
sure
he wants to get back to that in Barcelona. And then, you know, when we come back and our exhibition season resumes, our preseason resumes, you know, then we'll kind of meter out how to bring him along. But, you know, he's not doing a whole lot of full court running, pounding right now, but he's doing the activity, jumping, shooting, slides, those type of things he's still working on, and strength is really the issue for him right now.
Well, we're certainly looking forward to watching you guys go for another three-peat. Wish you the best of luck. Thanks for taking
some
time.
Thanks, man.
All right,
thanks.
Congratulations.
Phil Jackson joining us here in El Segundo, California, as the L.A. Lakers get ready for their season here on Real Training Camp. We're going to take a quick timeout. Back with more after this. Boy, how much fun was that, watching Kobe Bryant? I remember at the beginning of the season, I was looking at a stat. It was, I believe it was game winners since 2005. And the guy who led the who had the most, I remember a lot of people were surprised, it was Dirk Nowitzki. It wasn't Kobe. And it was almost as if Kobe heard somebody say that last season, and he just went off and hit all those game winners. He is so much fun to watch. We saw him with the wrap on his knee, and he said he's, you know, the finger should be fine. He's looking to play through that. This is one of the all-time greats, as we are here at Real Training Camp with the L.A. Lakers. And, Norm, talk about, you know, his place in history. A lot of people want to compare him to Michael Jordan, and look, it's part of what we do. You compare the greatest players to the other great players. Talk about how he compares.
Well, he's going to have his own place. I mean, I'm one of those that don't think there's ever been the greatest player to walk on the court, because
right.
What do you imagine? Championships, you got to go with Russell. Points, you know, it's with Chamberlain. So it's very hard. But when you look at these two guys, these are definitely two of the best guards to ever step out on the court. What they bring to the table that a lot of players don't bring, their tenacity, their desire to win, their ability to do whatever it takes to win, both of those guys have had that. Michael's stats, I think, have been better than Kobe's. Michael's won more championships than Kobe as we're speaking now.
Right.
But Kobe still has a couple more, still will have a couple more seasons left.
And this is going to be interesting to see, because with Kobe, you know, you look at the, you know, more seasons at a younger age, so it's going to be interesting to see how he finishes his career, because it's not what age you are, it's what age are you at.
This is what I say, the miles are the miles.
Right.
Whether you start at 17 or whether you start at 21, 82 games, and the miles are the miles.
All right. What did you learn from today watching this team take an early practice?
Well, number one, I'm impressed with the guys that they drafted. Very talented young guys. E-Banks, I'm impressed with. Character, I'm impressed with. The second thing, I was surprised at how simple the practice was. It was a very basic, fundamental practice. In training camp, I've never been to a camp that had such an easy day. But again, that's part of the genius of Phil, understanding how to take his team, how to pace his team, how to pace the training camp. He's dealing with a lot of veterans, and he's not going to allow these guys to get hurt because of some simple and silly in training camp. So I was that was the most interesting part
right.
of the practice for me today.
And it is going to be interesting to watch this team in the early going. Look, Lamar Odom played a lot of basketball in the offseason.
Yes.
We know about Bynum and his injury, and we know about Kobe Bryant coming off of the knee injury and having to deal with the finger as well. Well, we hope you enjoyed it. Real Training Camp with the Los Angeles Lakers. We're wrapping this one up. For Norm Nixon and everybody behind the scenes, I'm Mark. Mark Fine. Look forward to seeing you again next time.